something we call the Heisman Trophy Watch. And that's just exactly what we do. We watch the performances of Heisman Trophy candidates. Now, there may be more candidates as we go along, but even now, we know we're going to keep a close eye on Napoleon McCallum of Navy, the first redshirt in the history of the service academies. Two Big Ten quarterbacks, Chuck Long of Iowa and Jack Trudeau, is all set to break all of Tony Eason's records at Illinois. Still in the Big Ten, Ohio State's big running back Keith Byers, top rusher in the land last year. Ken Davis of TCU, not far behind Byers with more than 1,600 yards. Bo Jackson of Auburn, and the pride of the West, Reuben Mays of Washington State. And you cannot possibly overlook Dalton Hilliard of LSU. Those posters all over Louisiana say he is the man. Now, the man at Brigham in a seemingly
the only bow they know is Schembechler. In the South, however, there's only one bow. Vincent Bo Jackson, Auburn University's Heisman Trophy candidate, who got his nickname because his brother said he was as tough as a boar hog.
Of course, Bo, we think, is a top football player in America, and Bo is, he's one of a kind. And right now, he's got the combination of speed and power and finesse. How you could win any more than a running back.
As the 1985 college football season begins, this trophy, perhaps more than anything else, will be linked with Bo Jackson's name. He's one of a select group of athletes, Heisman Trophy candidates. Now, whether he remains that way depends in a large part on his performance, that of his competitors, and an awful lot on publicity. Now, despite the fact that Bo Jackson is not a self-promoter, he is a publicist's dream come true.
Life with drugs in trouble, it's not worth it.
And if this you is Bo Jackson smart, at his best. He's a child psychology major who, despite a slight speech impediment, talks to kids two or three times a week. And every time, his message is the same.
I enjoy talking to you, and I hope you all continue to excel in athletics and in academics. Academics come first here.
I use being an athlete, a well-known athlete, to the advantage of I could go out and I could talk to any kids that I want to, and they listen.
You take on a responsibility of caring for other people. Why is that?
Well, I guess because when I was growing up, nobody really had time to care for me or show me the ropes and what was wrong and what was right. I just did it on my own, and whatever I did, 90% of the time, I thought it was right, but in somebody else's eyes, it was wrong.
Now that he's the consummate Mr. Nice Guy, Bo Jackson can do no wrong, especially in athletic endeavors. He came back from a shoulder separation to lead Auburn to a Liberty Bowl win over Arkansas last year. And as a baseball player, he hit over 300 and was drafted by the California Angels this spring.
Nicest conclusion to the season, to the whole situation, would be for Bo to complete his senior year at Auburn, play football, win the Heisman Trophy, and beyond that, someday be a California Angel.
Despite his athletic accomplishments, Bo Jackson just wants to be remembered as a nice guy. Which, if you'd ever met him, I'm sure you'd agree he is. Unless you met him in the middle of a football field on a fall Saturday.
I think that I am entitled to 1.5 to 2 hours just to be the meanest person in the world. That is the way that I consider myself once I step out on the field on Saturday. The meanest person in this stadium. Nobody's going to whoop me. Nobody's going to hit me. I'm going to deliver all the licks, and I'm going to be the victor in the end. That's the way I am.
Well, that's Jackson, and the next Bo you'll meet ain't diddly. He's Schembechler. Bo and the Big Ten when the race for number one continues.
The SEC offers this vital statistic. The conference sent 5 of its 10 teams to a bowl game last year. This season, the SEC race looks to be competitive once again. But when all is said and done, 1985 will probably be remembered as the year of the Tiger. The question is, which Tiger? The Auburn Tigers, already ranked number 2 in the nation, begin this season with the same old Bo Jackson, shoulder intact, and a new offense which features Bo in the eye. The other Tigers on the title prowl will be Bill Arnsparger's Bayou Bengals.
The Misfits of Sun.
The H-back kicked the corner out, and Tommy mowed down the rest of them, the fullback. He mowed down about 5 or 6 people, and there was nothing there, but they lied when I took it.
Just accelerated in the home.
Yes, and I noticed that there was only one guy down the field that could stop me, and I just turned it on and just went all out.
Were you conscious of any kind of record or anything?
No.
Would you like to have known about it?
No.
Didn't make any difference?
No, just let me go out and play on Saturday.
The Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you by Colonial Bank, the bank in your future. Long's Electronics, tomorrow's electronics today. Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Alabama Farm Bureau Insurance. With Farm Bureau, you know you've got the best. And by Snapper, manufacturer of quality power lawn equipment.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review. Auburn christened a new offense yesterday, and I would think the shakedown was pretty good, Coach.
Well, we obviously made some mistakes, but overall I was pleased with what we were able to do. I felt good going into the game, and I've said all along I feel good about this football team because they've been a fun group to coach and just be around. We got to play a lot of people yesterday, a lot of new faces, more new faces on defense, of course, than it was on offense. But overall, I thought it was a good day to open. Obviously, we were playing a team that was outmanned, and we knew that going in. And a lot of times you worry about a team being ready to play against that kind of opponent. But I just felt like our football team is going to be ready to play regardless of who's on the other sideline. And if they're as hungry as I am, we're going to be ready to play every Saturday.
Were you aware that Bo Jackson was flirting with a school record, conference record, NCAA record?
Well, we were. The one that I wasn't aware of that we probably could have gotten without too much trouble, I wasn't aware that I think they needed about 8 or 9 yards for Brent and Bo to set the NCAA record for most yardage rushing for 2 backs. I wasn't aware of that, but I was aware of the one for Bo, and I guess that maybe we should have done it, but he'll have other opportunities this year. So
it's a pretty good test of both those backs to see.
Well, ordinarily we wouldn't have left Bo in the game as long as we did, because obviously we were going to win the game and he was still out there. But I really wanted to kind of test him to see how many times he could carry the ball and all the heat conditions and so forth to kind of gauge where we are for games in the future. So we left him out there a little longer than we really wanted to. Wasn't trying to build up any yardage or anything. I just really wanted to watch him. Phil, I think that, a lot of people deserve the credit for yesterday's win. I think our coaching staff has done an outstanding job offensively and to put together what we're trying to do. And Jack Crow and Bud Casey and Larry Blakeney and Neil Calloway and James Daniels and Wayne Bolt. It's been a lot of fun experimenting and, putting all the pieces together, and I think that we've got a pretty good package. I thought that our defense played well yesterday. I think that as you look at the film and watching it from the sideline, it was more of a case of trying too hard in a lot of instances where we should have come up with fumbles or interceptions. Maybe we were, you know, going for the man rather than the ball too much. So from what I could see yesterday, I'd have to say that I'm pleased. I haven't talked to the coaches or gotten the grades or anything, but overall, it was a good opening day. And under the circumstances, I know that, you know, we've got a lot tougher tests down the road, but it's a good way to get started.
Indeed it was. Let's go into the Auburn post-game dressing room.
But right now, my biggest concern is finding the right folks to line up and help us win in the toughest games we're going to play this year. And then we're going to, you know, once we get that settled, and we hadn't got them all settled yet, once we get that settled, then, you know, we'll get into trying to keep some of you happy and smiling by maybe letting you play some.
All right, this was the opening round. How did it go?
It went all right. You know, I still got a lot of things to work on, you know, and everybody got to play, you know, and I feel real good about it.
When I first went out on the field, it was like coming back for my first time and had a lot of butterflies, and I just, after I made my first contact, I kind of got over that.
We definitely had too many penalties, and we stopped ourselves on some drives that we shouldn't have done.
Several holding penalties.
Oh, yes.
You want to hear about that?
Oh, we'll hear about it tomorrow, most definitely.
It was really exciting for us to play and to watch. I saw Bo go for, what, over 250 yards?
290 yards.
Exciting.
Y'all had a shot at a goose egg, but it kind of got away there, a couple of turnovers.
Yeah, they ran a little gadget play, I guess, and what's bad is we worked on it Thursday. We ran against it one time Thursday, and we had the guys out there. The guy just really went after the ball and got it, and those things going to happen. I think overall we had a good day defensively.
Well, I feel really great about starting for the first time in college ball, and we had a pretty good game. I think our defense overall played pretty well together. We had some young guys in there. They got some playing time, and so we're happy about this game.
Well, it was hot out there, but, you know, after a couple of snaps, we didn't even notice the heat, just the sweat rolling in your eyes. It was about it.
It was a pretty good day for the defense. I think our young people got some valuable experience today.
Were you a rookie today?
Nah.
Did you feel like one?
Nope. I felt pretty comfortable. It didn't bother me. You know, once I got out there and made contact, I felt like, you know, just like riding a bicycle, I felt normal again.
Tell the truth now, would you really rather have been fishing today?
That's a tough question. Why would you ask me something like that?
I don't know. I just thought.
I don't know.
You didn't think about that.
No comment.
You know, at Long's Electronics, we have
a lot of heat.
A lot of things going against our crowd, because I was really disappointed in the crowd. But the students are not back at school, and being on television and playing in 95-degree heat, and there's just a lot of things going against us. But
Chris Johnson got his kick.
I hope we'll get the folks out next week. I've tried to tell them that we're going to have an exciting team to watch. I tell you, Phil, Southwest was outmanned, but they played hard throughout the contest, and I got to have a lot of respect for their kids. And fine play right here by Ben McCurdy. And we played a lot of, you're going to hear a lot of names you haven't heard before as far as playing it on. This first play of the game right here, we just wanted to hand it off to Tommy A.G. And Tommy A.G., I would say that there's a good chance that he may go down as the best blocking fullback in the country this year. And that's the first big run by Bo. He's breaking tackles, running a sprint draw. And
42 yards.
He takes it in on the sweep here as Tommy, the whole line, because from end to end, you take Jeff Parks and Ron Middleton and Steve Wallace and Steve Wilson and Yan Cowart and Ben Tamborella. Those guys are men. They've played a lot of football at Auburn, and Tommy and of course, Reggie Ware and Brent Fullwood come in later. And all three of the quarterbacks did some good things yesterday, and it's a situation where we'll have to get back and evaluate the film and just kind of see where we are there. There's fine play by the entire defensive front, Gerald Williams and Harold Hallman. And
you put Perkins in there.
I think it, that guy right there has the kind of year he could have. Gerald Robinson, and I think he got three sacks yesterday. He will really have a tremendous effect on our defense. That was a fourth down play, I guess, really. And mm-hmm. here's a big run by Bo right here. Steve Wilson right there kicking at the...
That acceleration.
And Scott Bolton made a good block on the corner out there. Just the crease opened up, and of course, when you get the crease and that guy with the speed that he's got, and it makes it look mighty easy. His fine play right there by Harold Hallman, and
that's a
Tracy Rocker. Tracy Rocker and Ron Stallworth and Buford Perry. This is a beautiful pass right here. It's called back from holding. Bobby hits Trey Gaines between the 1 and the 9 with it. And come back and makes a bad throw right here. I'm going to blame Freddie a little bit for that. I think he could have come back for the ball a little better than he did. But Bobby didn't put enough on it. That's a freshman mistake. And those are down here to eliminate. Situation like that right there. There's Russ Carricker that had a fine game yesterday at linebacker. The ball hit him between his number. There's Gerald Robinson, Harold Hallman, and Gerald Williams, and Nate Hill, all around the football. Pat Thomas had a fine day yesterday. I'm excited for Pat. He's had a great fall. This is another big run. Tommy Agee right there. I don't know whether you got that again or not, but Tommy Agee got it. Three guys on the ground. He led.
Yan Coward kind of set him up, and then he finished him off. Watch this.
Yan, I guess, is pulling.
Oh, no, and we didn't have a recall.
This is Brent coming back.
This is second quarter now.
But Jeff Park sealed him off, and Ron Middleton kicked him out, and Yan and Tommy led him up through. This is pass interference here on Freddie. We're trying to develop a deep passing game.
That guy's a great relief man for number 34, Coach.
Well, he's I think everybody knows that Boomer's talented, and they won't get much relief when Bo goes out of the ballgame, that's for sure. Curtis Stewart played yesterday. Wish we'd played Curtis a little more than we did. This is a fine play by Pat Washington. This is a good drive right here where Pat took him, I think, 70-something yards and 10, 11 plays, and he hit Scott Bolton right there and a little under route, and fine play to Kyle Collins.
Third down play there.
Kyle is going to be an important part of our football team this year, utilizing him as a H-back, and he can play tailback, a fullback, a wide out, or anywhere, and he's a great leader for us. And this is probably, in my opinion, the worst thing that we did yesterday right here, and that's Andre Bruce making a great play, running the guy down. But they ran the ball back out to around the 50-yard line, and as Brian Smith, Opelika, and he got pressure on the quarterback, and Alex Duchok makes a play on it on the screen. I like what I see with our defense, Phil. I don't think that we're close to being where we can be. This is just a sweep, and Bo gets the ball and gets inside, outside. You know, when he gets a ball running from our formation, this is a triple option. Fine play right here by Bobby throwing to Trey Gaines on the deep turn in.
Second receiver, wasn't it?
Well, he's going to the post, and the post wasn't open, so here's another foul up. He turns into a touchdown. He actually went the wrong way, but he doesn't lose his composure, and actually, I don't know whether he's directing traffic or what. He's doing something. But
6 points, anyway.
There's Ben McCurdy and Tommy Powell and Jimmy Warren and Shan Marsh, number 20. That's a number that you... There's a fine play by Ron Stallworth. Gary Kelly.
Kelly made several plays.
He's had a good fall. He's done well. There's Neil Vinson.
That was a third and one. They stopped him.
I don't think they converted a third down play yesterday, which might be a record for us. There's fine play by Jeff Berger pitching the ball on the option to Brent Fullwood, and Brent turns it into a nice run. There's a Montgomery guy right there, Anthony McCall, number one.
You know, the clock's running out here, and you got down here, and you made no effort to stop
Reggie,
the clock.
Reggie Ware running the read play, and Jeff taking it outside, good read, good pitch. Pitches the ball to Brent, and
That is a multifaceted offense.
Well, we're running a wishbone out of the eyes of what we're doing, and we've got the eye formation plays where the backs get the ball and you know, different running angles to the line of scrimmage, and I hope we can go ahead and develop a passing game off of it that is going to complement the running game.
We'll be back in just a minute. You really had an opportunity to play a lot of people yesterday with a big lead early.
Well, we did, and we played a lot of people. I think we played around 70 kids and played everybody that we wanted to play. We didn't play some of them as much as I would like to play them, but I wanted to look at the front line players, the guys that we're going to be counting on to line up and play with the entire year and get as much film on them as we could. We didn't, this is probably another disappointing thing. We came out and didn't make a first down after the half. And of course, that was uncalled for because we should have made a first down every time we had it. But gave Lewis Coburn an opportunity to hit this 77 yards. Lewis has had an outstanding call, and it seems like our punting game is in good shape. If we can get our field goal, as Harold Hallman and Ray Corrin.
Third and two.
Fine play right here. That was another third down play. Ray Corrin, Tommy Powell, Nate Hill.
You want to see your quarterbacks throw the ball some too, didn't you, Coach?
Yes, and we just kind of worked on, you know, what we wanted to look at. We just called our whole offense. There's Bobby Walden hitting Jeff Berger on a little delay route. Bobby running an option to the weak side. Fine block by Tommy A.G., and you're going to hear that all year long. I can't wait to see how many knockdowns he had yesterday. Bobby threw in the double coverage there. Again, that's just a mistake that he's got to eliminate. You want a quarterback not to be afraid, and he's not afraid. He's got a lot of courage, but he has other alternatives than to throw in the double coverage like that. That's fine play by Harold Hallman, and another sack by Gerald Robinson. And good pressure on the quarterback right here. Harold Hallman snatched the ball out of the quarterback's hand with a three-man rush. If we can get pressure with a three-man rush from those guys, then our pass defense should be adequate. Fine play right here by Jeff Berger coming out on a little option pass. He had the pass covered, and he pitched the ball back to Bo and picks up 10 or 12 yards. I think Jeff had a fine day yesterday. You don't realize it so much. He hits Freddie Wagan with a big pass, and Freddie makes a great catch on the play. Comes back inside the cornerback and sets up a touchdown. I didn't realize Jeff didn't throw the ball but twice yesterday. And like I said, you don't realize those things until...
Had a good steady day.
He did. Another fine block right there. You can see Tommy knocking down number six and getting Bo in the end zone.
Good instincts there to go.
As Bo's mother and sister and father and brother, the whole family.
They got an eyeful, didn't they?
I'm
telling you.
They like to come to the games and always enjoy it. There's a big hit right there by the freshman, Shan Morris from Atlanta. Shan's father, Larry Morris, was one of the all-time greats at Georgia Tech. And fine play by Gary Kelly.
These are names and numbers you haven't seen in a while.
That's exactly right. Good pressure right there by Tracy Rocker, and another good pressure. And there's Benji Roller, number 96, chasing him. Just a little more, Benji, you get there. And Russ Carricker knocking him out of bounds. That's, of course, an interception and sets up that touchdown. Actually, the guard missed an assignment there and allowed the penetration hit pad as he was throwing the ball. And here's a throwback to the quarterback, one of the oldest plays in the book. And actually, we changed our defense. They thought we were going to be in man coverage. We went back to zone and had people in position to cover it. This is a two-play drive here. You're going to see probably the best run of the day is right here.
Watch this. Mercy.
As far as just one deal, he gets hit right there.
Watch this block right there, too.
How he comes out of it. There's Brent Gilbert following him down the field. And
no contest now.
And he gets in the opening just like Bo. And
173 yards for Brent yesterday.
Well, that was a pretty big day for him.
Yeah.
I think he ran the ball, what, 10 times?
11 times.
11 times. Mm-hmm. They come back, and there's Shan Morris again on the tackle.
Open field.
Throwing, there's good pressure on the quarterback. Fine play by Russ Carrick. I think Russ had more individual tackles than anybody on the field defensively. Fine punt. It was an excellent return by Freddie Wagan. There's a good block right there. Set the wall. Freddie breaks a couple of tackles. And we can have a fine return game with Freddie and Trey Gaines if we take a lot of pride in setting the wall and holding them up. The punter for Southwest yesterday.
There's that shuttle pass again.
That's right. Who made the play on that? That was Tracy Rocker and Benji Rowland. And there's Tracy Rocker again on the sack. Those young defensive linemen looked like they had a good time yesterday. So it was, this is the last drive of the day. Curtis Stewart. Curtis goes down, and we got a lot of youngsters in there. Curtis makes 89 yards. There's Stacy Dunn and Vincent Jones and Jay Helms. I guess that's Tamborello at center now. Pat Johnson got a lot of folks in the game.
Coach Sam Robertson had a tough day.
Right, Sam. I told him after the game that his kids, he ought to be proud of them. They hung in there, they never quit. They kept fighting. And we scored twice the second half.
Mm-hmm.
And against a tired football team, and that's proof right there that they didn't quit. They're doing the right things. But when you're outmanned, and that was the case yesterday.
We'll be back with some comments about next week in just a minute. Here's miss next week, no TV. Great chance to see a lot of offense, Coach.
Well, Southern Mississippi looked like they handled Louisiana Tech pretty well. He should be a lot stronger football team than we played
they
yesterday,
got a shutout.
For sure. But this is an exciting football team to watch, and you'll miss a show if you don't come.
Next Saturday, 1:30, Jordan-Hare, and we'll see you next Sunday with the replay. Thank you.
The Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye has been brought to you by Colonial Bank, the bank in your future. Long's Electronics, tomorrow's electronics today. Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Alabama Farm Bureau Insurance. With Farm Bureau, you know you've got the best. And by Snapper, manufacturers of quality power lawn equipment.
We can't be fielding punts in the end zone, and we can't be letting punts hit the ground and roll, and we can't be fumbling punts, and we can't be throwing interceptions deep down the field and in a double coverage, and we can't be turning the ball over in situations like we did out there today. We can't lose containment. We can't do all of the little things today that are just basic fundamental football, men. Basic fundamental football. Some of the things that happened out there today borderline on an individual being concerned about himself. And I hope we don't have that kind of situation at all. At all. This football team has got too much to let any personal, individual goals get in the way of us being as good as we can be. Now, enjoy the win. And it was a big win for you. It was a big win for you, but just taking consideration, men, the things that went against us out there today and being able to win against a pretty good football team in spite of them.
Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you by Colonial Bank, the bank in your future. Long's Electronics, tomorrow's electronics today. Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Alabama Farm Bureau Insurance. With Farm Bureau, you know you've got the best. And by Snapper, manufacturer of quality power lawn equipment.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review. Yesterday, in a kind of a brisk Saturday afternoon at Jordan-Hare, Auburn knocked down Southern Miss 29-18. It was maybe not the most enjoyable victory you've had, Coach, but a victory nevertheless.
Well, Phil, we might have learned more about our football team yesterday than we did in the first ball game, and we're still trying to find out what our personality is going to be. You know, I really don't know. Offensively, we are trying to settle into and try a little of everything to find out what we can really hang our hat on in the games that we've got coming up. I think that Southern Mississippi deserves a lot of credit for some of the problems we had yesterday. I think they're a fine football team, and they were ready to play, no question about it. And looking at the tape, and I think that we probably had some individuals that played really well against Southern. But as a team, I didn't think we played as well as we should have, and we can. I think that the defense made some things happen. The offense put the defense in the hole, which is very difficult. I think that if we go out and we don't make the mistakes offensively, then I think we win the game pretty easily. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, Southern was good to us and throwing the interceptions and so forth. But I think that some of those plays were good plays on our part. Mm-hmm. But I think now we can look at the film. I think that we can really evaluate our football team after yesterday, and I'm not discouraged in the least bit as far as our football team is concerned. I just think that we have got to not turn the football over. We played two games, I think, and turned it over eight times in two games, haven't we? 1983, we turned it over, I think, 16 times in 11 ball games. So we certainly cannot get into the posture of being a turnover type football team. I mean, we're not good enough on defense to be that kind of football team. You can't if you gonna turn it over, then every turnover is worth 40 yards in field position. We're not good enough offensively to put the defense in that kind of bind, and when you turn it over, you can't score. So there's a combination of all of it, but I think we can look at the film. You're going to see some big licks and some big hits, and I didn't so much get the feeling that we weren't playing hard in the football game. Phil, it was just that I didn't think we made more mental mistakes in the game than I can ever remember one of our football teams making. And the thing that disturbed me was that it wasn't the young players making the mental mistakes, it was Owens. And we got to do a little soul searching in that regard, because we can't make them when we play Tennessee.
Okay, let's hear what the players had to say in the post-game dressing room.
But it was a W.
It was, and that's the thing that counts. You know, we got to learn from our mistakes and carry on next week and just do, come back against Tennessee and be ready for them.
I think we played all right, but we didn't play a great game to get on defense. We just got to get better because the true test is next week in playing Tennessee.
So. Actually, we wanted to play a little better. We played pretty good, but we have to play a lot better next time we play.
Yeah, they have they're going to throw wave after wave of wide out there.
They're wide open up there.
Now you got to go to Knoxville. They really have the wide open passing attack.
Yeah, they got a really tough receiving McGee and quarterback Tony Robinson. He's pretty good. We just got to stop those here too.
Can't make the mistakes we made today and beat and win that there.
No way.
Mistakes were costly, I believe. We didn't execute the way we wanted to in the first half. I think we came out in the second half and did a little better, but we got a long way to go, especially playing Tennessee.
We did win, but a lot of the guys know they did kind of bad on little things.
We're going to try to correct that on our break.
Well, you're now a statistic. You have an interception.
Right. I'm certainly proud of that. First one ever in college.
I don't recall you shaking any tacklers, though, after you.
I wasn't exactly number 34, was I? Looked more like 52 when I got a hold of it.
Fall weather, windy conditions at Jordan-Hare yesterday, and a good crowd, and we begin on Auburn's second series of the first quarter.
I don't think we moved the ball the first series. They may not move it here. We just, we've kind of trying to decide what Southern was going to do, and it didn't take us long to find out that the first thing they were going to do was going to get after us. You can see that hit right there by that safety man, and they really played hard, and they're a good defensive football team. They're quick, and I was very, very impressed. I was impressed going in.
That number one ranking can get heavy to...
Well, they're going to, everybody we play is going to be at a peak performance, and, you know, we've got to get ready to live for that. I don't think we'll be number one after this week, but if we are, then it's certainly not going to help us as far as other teams are concerned, because they're going to be just as much ready. That was a great play by the quarterback Duckworth there, and a fine tackle by Jimmy Warren. I think that defensively, feels spottedly, we had some real fine play yesterday. This is a little guy breaking the containment. Now, I want to tell you something. He would break containment on a lot of people. He had over 100 yards rushing last week. Gary Kelly makes a tackle on him.
Got injured.
Got hurt right there and went out of the ball game. And Andrew Anderson came in and I thought did a fine job, except, you know, maybe throwing a couple of interceptions.
Starting the second quarter now, same drive.
He's got play by Edward Phillips there.
That was a third and long.
I think they got a thrown for a loss, and then they come back and kick a field goal and makes it 3-0 Southern Miss. Now, this is probably the sign of the Auburn team right here and what it could be, and they come right back and answer the call of the 3 points, and both reels off about 35 yards there on the counter sweep. And
that play worked well.
And I think in about 4 plays, we got it in the end zone. So, you know, that is what we're capable of. And we probably threw the ball deep too much yesterday. We had some opportunities to throw deep, but we need to develop a short passing game and be a little more consistent with it. Again, that's fine blocking right there by Yan Cowart, and Ed's bow breaking a tackle and making...
Wasn't long after this that Yan got his bell rung.
Well, I think he was on that play.
Yeah.
That was on that play. You're going to see a fine run here by Tommy A.G. Trap up the middle and goes in from about 15 yards out for the touchdown. That's Ben Tamborello and Jeff Lott, Steve Wilson, Steve Wallace, Stacy Searles. And it took us, like I said, 4 plays to go out front. And we stay out front from here. And
number 30 was a blocker and a scorer yesterday.
Yep. There's a play right there by Richard Manry. Kickoff. Again, you can see us getting around the football, and I saw Gerald Williams make a lot of plays. There's Harold Hallman getting pressure on the quarterback, and Jimmy Warren coming up with interception. Good return right here. Got a little sudden change going. Blocked by Ray Corrin. Gets the ball back inside the 20, and I think we score the first play from scrimmage. Mm-hmm. Run a little bootleg play, and Jeff hits Tommy A.G. out in the flat for the touchdown.
That guy goes with A.G.
Fine block right there by Trey Gaines.
Sure was.
Just the guy never, he just got right on him and stuck on him, and Trey had.
See the block right there?
Yes, Trey had two catches in the bowl game yesterday that were unbelievable.
They were.
A fine play right there by Gerald Williams again, and I think that, you know, from a running game inside. This is a tip ball. I don't know who tipped that ball, but Kevin Porter comes up with the interception, and you can see we got some folks trying to get in front of him, and that's big plays on the part of the defense, and that's the things that you got to have to be able to be a great defensive football team. You got to make something happen and score on defense and get the ball in. Wasn't many cracks up in there. Bo got 200 yards yesterday, but it wasn't easy.
A lot of carries, though.
That's fine run by Tommy Tommy A.G., there's Rob Shula and Eric Floyd in there.
It's a great run here.
Reggie Ware turns back on the goal line and picks up a couple. Always working, trying to get in front of that ball carrier, stay in front of it. You can see him turn back there and get.
Going for two.
Come up just a little short. Really, Phil, I think that, you know, we had a situation there where we should have kicked the extra point yesterday. As Alexander, their fine tailback, he is a good little runner, tackled by Gary Kelly. This is a good goal line stand right here. Arthur Johnson and company. And Kevin Porter blocks the field goal. Kevin, I think, played well yesterday, except for the long pass of the touchdown. And, you know, the guy pulled the ball down and scrambled. It was a fine run by Jeff Berger on the option.
A lot of option yesterday.
I expect Jeff's going to make a lot of long runs this year because they're not going to let us pitch the ball. There's one of the catches right there to Trey. Just laid out and went and got it. I really think Freddie caught this ball right here. I thought he caught it and then fumbled it and got back on it. But the official said he didn't. He's a lot closer to it than I was.
Stop.
That was, third and two. We can't get into the, you know, we've just got to have more pride in the short yard situations and make them, come up with them.
It's just before the half now.
Throwing to the tight end, come back and pressure. Gerald Williams, I don't know how many sacks Gerald had yesterday, but he had to have at least three or four.
Comes the interception.
As Ben McCurdy, happy for Ben, getting the interception. He looked like he was right back in that area where he's supposed to be on that particular route.
49 now, time to get something on the board.
Well, we're trying to get the ball in field goal range. And
just 20 seconds left.
Jeff gets the ball to. And we had a mental mistake right there. The tackle was supposed to come over and give us an extra protector on the side that the ball blocked on, and we didn't get him moved over, and the guy just came free. And just the little things like that, Phil, is what keeps you awake at night.
Productive second quarter, 19-3 at the half. We'll be back in just a minute.
We're at play now, and a lot of action crammed in these first few minutes, Coach. Not exactly all Auburn's action.
Well, that's right.
Fact,
the
we'll get to it.
Starts the second half. Anderson, that quarterback, scrambles out and makes a great play. Just the guy stepped behind our secondary and I think a 78-yard touchdown pass. We had good pressure on him right here. That's the start of the second half. And as Gerald Williams again, and just looking at it, Gerald just played really a great football game. I think he probably would have got to him right there. There he is. Went ahead and throws a perfect strike to.
Close to being over the line of scrimmage.
Right, and it's one of those broken plays that, again, you can't come up in the secondary until the guy is past the line of scrimmage. It's one of the things you just got to learn. Southern defense is swarming again.
Here's a misfortune
right
there. He kicks the kind of ball with his leg.
Ordinarily, Freddie just catch up in the first. Then that was an interception that was not the quarterback's fault.
Now they have it at the Auburn 23.
Scott Bolton comes back and makes the tackle, along with Tommy A.G. Our defense bows up here and does a good job of stopping them. Stopped by the entire middle of the defensive line right there. With
second and nine here.
Here's a good play by Nate Hill.
Third and long.
Getting a little pressure around him, and Kevin Porter makes a nice play in the end zone to break it up. And
so
they come in and kick a field goal. So we dodged a bullet right there. The defense went out and did what they had to do to hold them at least to a field goal. And just don't like to put the defense in that kind of hole.
Quick answer, though, again.
We come right back, and Bo runs a counter sweep for 10 or 12 yards. Tommy A.G. for two or three up the middle. And we really
move the football pretty well the second half. I feel that if we just don't turn the football over, like I said, we're gonna do about what we want to. But
what a great catch! Watch it
that
again.
That was a patented Freddie Wagan catch for sure. And he is laid out. And I tell you, we've got some wide receivers that will go get the football. You're gonna see one later that's just as good as Bo going in the end zone for the touchdown. And I think there was
205 yards for Bo yesterday, 2 touchdowns.
Well, I think that we found out that something else yesterday as far as our football team is concerned. And I think that, we're through experimenting. It's a great play on that part right here. Not very good on ours. There's a missed tackle right there and a couple. And Alexander is a fine runner. And he makes a nice play on the screen pass. Come back and it looked like our defensive front must have played pretty well.
And
as Pat Thomas with a big play, and I noticed Pat had 7, 8, 10 tackles in the ball game and just maybe 11. But that was a big sack and a big play and forced them to punt the football. And we just can't field the ball there on the 2-yard line. And that's, we got to be more aware of where we are, and it's a situation like that is critical.
Coming out with
now, the same guy comes back and makes an unbelievable catch.
He
turned his whole body loose, and
what a great catch!
He absolutely did. And Freddie catches one going out of bounds, and again we're moving the ball right down the field, running a little, throwing a little, and Bo makes a nice run here. Looks like he's fixing to come out of there with it.
45 stripped it.
And he gets away from it. So we turn it over again. And
that was just a 23-yard line right there.
Going in. So it was not very pretty on our part. You're going to see Gerald Williams is harassing the quarterback all day long. Great hit right there by Kevin Porter. I'm telling you, that was a... it was a pass that was actually caught as Harold Hallman and Gerald Williams runs him out of bounds for a 3 or 4 yard loss. And that punter's got his knee on the ground and the ball is down at the our 39 yard line.
Jeff Berger went practically the entire way.
Well, you know, I had said we weren't going to alternate the quarterbacks, and I didn't want to get into the situation where we were moving them in and out. I really wanted to see, you know, what we need to find out what our real true personality is going to be at that position too. Of course, Bobby Walden was hurt all week and didn't practice. And I told him I wasn't going to play him unless, you know, we had got a situation where we could play him and where he wouldn't be a factor in the ball game. That was fine. Another fine play by Gerald Williams and Gary Kelly.
Third and long coming in. Watch this. Boy, he really got sandwiched.
That's right there between two pretty
Some
good
guy
hands.
Guy said on the radio he didn't see any hitting yesterday. I don't know which game he was at.
Well, he certainly didn't come to the Auburn Southern Mississippi game because it was some licks passed on our part and it was some passed on their part too. In fact, I want to tell you something. You play Southern Mississippi, it's going to be physical.
They've really
on
built
one
the
side anyway.
They have really built the program.
Well, they got hungry kids. They got, I think, 19 or 20 kids from the state of Alabama, and this is another one of the critical mistakes that we made yesterday, and it was just, you know, the ball hit Lewis right in the hands, and
sets up another score.
You know, when you got a 2-touchdown lead, it may not be so critical, a 3-touchdown lead or whatever we had at the time, but, you know, if it's a 2 or 3-point game or 6-point game, then, you know, you got a real problem.
He gets it in.
And that makes it, they go for 2 here and sacked by Brian Smith. Brian Smith made some big plays yesterday. Phil, and Brian's getting better every day, and that wound up the score in 29-18, and Southern Mississippi's got a fine football team, and I think we got a chance to be a fine football team if we can just eliminate the little things that are keeping us from being one now.
We'll be back in just a minute.
Auburn is off next Saturday, so there will be no Auburn Tiger football nor an Auburn football review program next weekend. We'll be back on the 29th, though, with the replay of Auburn, Tennessee from Knoxville. Join us for that. We'll see you next time.
I'm mighty proud of you for not quitting in the second half and coming back and fighting. And being respectful. We've got an awful long way to go to have a good football team in. It's not impossible. Nothing's impossible. I doubt very seriously if there'll be a football team in our conference that goes through the season undefeated. You can still get back in the conference race. You can get in back in the national championship race. But those things are going to have to come from a lot of hard work and dedication, pulling together, and it'll certainly test the fibers in all of you and the coaching staff. Nothing in the world worthwhile is easy, men. So let's get undressed, get dressed, and get home.
The Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you by Colonial Bank, the bank in your future. Long's Electronics, tomorrow's electronics today. Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Alabama Farm Bureau Insurance. With Farm Bureau, you know you've got the best. And by Snapper, manufacturer of quality power lawn equipment.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review. They tore the goalpost down at Neyland Stadium yesterday. Tennessee 38, Auburn 20. I guess they had good reason, Coach. I guess the athletic department didn't mind paying for them.
Well, it was certainly Tennessee's day, Phil, and we kind of helped them along. It was obvious from the very beginning, and obviously I did a poor job of getting our football team prepared to go into the kind of environment we went into. You cover every base and turn every stone, and still sometimes you don't get the message across, and obviously I didn't get the message across as to the kind of effort and the kind of intensity that we had to play with because of the way Tennessee was going to be playing. I knew that they'd be a different football team than they had been for one reason alone, because of Ken Donahue. Mm-hmm. Their defense was well prepared. They played harder than any Tennessee defense that we've played against since I've been at Auburn. And that's a compliment to the players and the coaching staff. We made entirely too many mistakes offensively.
Especially early.
Turnovers and penalties and the kind of mistakes we've made in the first two ball games. You know, we've talked about it, and we just haven't gotten it corrected on the practice field. And until we do, we're just going to be an average, ordinary football team. And have no chance to beat a good football team. And we're going to play good football teams from here on out. We don't play any that we can play that poorly and win against. Defensively, we gave up a lot of big plays. I give a lot of credit to, of course, the Tennessee offense and their plan. Their plan was no different than it's been the last 3 years or 4 years for that matter. They've been doing the same thing, and we've held them to 14 points, I think, is the most that they've scored against us. But you have to give credit to Robinson, their quarterback, and, of course, their wide receivers and the offensive line did a good job of protecting the passer. But Robinson had an unbelievable amount of big plays, pulling the ball down and running it, scrambling and hitting an open guy, and just doing a great job of throwing to receivers on deep routes. You know, and I said going into the game that he had the best touch of any quarterback that I've seen throwing all the passes.
You sure proved it.
The intermediate routes, the short stuff, and the deep route. He's got he throws a fade route, a perfect strike. He throws the takeoffs, his two of those long ones, and the deep outs, and the little old backs coming out of the backfield. He does a great job with them. Plus the fact that he's a senior that has been in their offense and gets them into the right plays at the line of scrimmage. And, it really doesn't make any difference. He's done it so much that you disguise and, we gave him some problems yesterday and got a little pressure to him, but he had enough poise to come right back and take advantage of what you were doing on defense.
Okay, we'll see more of that in just a minute. Now let's go in the post-game locker room, visit with some of the players.
We just didn't do the things that we had planned and worked on doing.
Guys like you now have to take charge, right?
Yes, sir. I'm a senior, and I got to go back next week and show some leadership and see if we can regroup and come back together next week.
Tell me, football's a crazy game. If you had known you'd intercept three balls, you would have believed it would have been different, huh?
That's true.
You think you could score on the last one?
Well, I thought I could have, but I fell short.
Looks like you maybe ran 100 yards to get about 40.
Yeah, it was a long way.
What happened?
I didn't know.
I think it was the beginning of the third quarter. No, it was the middle of the third quarter. We ran a draw play. I ran up the middle, and somebody grabbed me by my ankles, and I sort of like fell on my own self and kind of hurt my knee. I hurt it at the beginning of the season, but it's like every time I like fall on it wrong or do something, it just nags me for a couple of hours. So I said the best thing, this is just to take myself out, because last year when I went back in and played while I was injured, I hurt myself worse.
Well, it's not the first time a young quarterback has come to Knoxville, but you've got another trip to make, and do you think you'll be a little wiser next time?
I think so. Maybe this is a learning experience, but I just wish it wouldn't ended up this way.
How are you physically?
I'm all right.
And when we first went out there, and they came out there and started taking the fight to us, and we let it get a little bit out of hand before we decided to regroup.
They sent the tempo quick, and it was like hard to break after that. Once you get 95,000 screaming fans behind you in that particular situation, it's hard for a team to come back from behind.
He was audible in about 90% of the time, and I don't know how they were hearing what he was saying, because I couldn't hear what he was checking off to, but evidently they could.
What do you think it'd take to win a game like this? Both offenses have to be at a peak, don't they? I mean, you have to match them, don't you?
They really do, and probably a little more effort by the defense.
When I have an opportunity to watch them, it's
72 degrees at Neyland Stadium. Well, beautiful fall afternoon.
It was a beautiful day for football, Phil. And
this is their second series.
This is the first big play of the game. We had them in a third and long situation, and Robinson pulls it down and runs right up the gut. We win. Underneath man coverage, and the linebackers would run out of there with the backs, and you just hit a seam right up the middle, and finally Kevin Porter makes a play on it. Kevin Porter again makes a tackle. It was a third and short situation where they threw us a little quick stop route, and they go right on in and score, and right off the bat, we're behind. And that's the first drive. We knew that we had to play well early in the ball game to take the crowd out of the game, and Jeff Berger hitting Jeff Parks for first down, but we don't move the football early and continue to help them and give them hope
This is third and long.
This is third and long, and nice play on the screen pass, but it wasn't quite enough for the first down. We fell 3 or 4 yards short on a third and 17, I believe. Right. So he picked up about 15 yards on it. Robinson comes back, and nice play by Nate Hill on the draw play. And Jill, I think that I still think we had a good plan for him.
We got beat
in some areas that if we could have just been just a little bit more, we would have been all right. We didn't run straight at them enough. We tried to take it outside too much early in the game instead of pinning them down inside and then making the outside game go. Here's the option play, the first turnover of the ball game where they stun inside and the linebacker penetrates and hits Jeff just as he's pitching the ball, and they end up with a ball on the 38-yard line. Doesn't take them long to go to work with Robinson, and he hits McGee in just a straight fly pattern down the field and right between the two eights. And we come back and move the ball a little right here, and Bo makes a nice run on just isolation. And we have a busted assignment right there with the back going the wrong way. And Bobby Walden came in at quarterback and throws an interception, gives him another turnover. I think we hold him here. And we get the ball back. They take it down, and Tommy Powell makes a great interception in the end zone. You can watch Robinson throwing the ball. That was about a 20-yard out cut there. And we got great pressure on him right here, and this was one of the few mistakes he made in the ball game. He kind of threw that one up, and Tommy Powell makes a great interception in the
caught
end zone.
One hand.
And we come out, and the yardage that we made early in the ball game basically was right at him, and we missed having a couple of snaps from Sunday yesterday, and I don't know, Phil, I don't know if whether it was a crowd that was affecting the play of the young quarterbacks or what, but we certainly didn't execute very well. As a draw play right there, and of course you get laid out on the rush for the passer, and it creates some seams in the defense. Tommy Powell comes up with another outstanding interception and gives us the ball back in pretty good field position. Bo comes out and makes a nice run.
As the quarter ends. Right? No, excuse me. Yeah, it's quarter, second quarter now.
We're making a little yardage inside, and of course the game is still, we get it down to the 30-yard line.
First down, a third down play there.
Right here, and we come back, and here's a turnover that was certainly a big one in the ball game. We had a little momentum and we had a little drive going, and we turn it over and give it right back to them. And of course they come back and take this one in to score. That's Davis, the tailback, and running the draw play. And you're gonna see us get some pressure on him, but he's so quick and such a great athlete that he gets away from it. As you can see, we got a hold of him, and he throws in the end zone, and that guy just breaks away from ours, and it's 21-0. All of the yardage is tough yardage. You can see a lot of Tennessee folks around the football. That defensive football was highly emotional and played hard and hit hard and did all the things a defense is supposed to do. Probably the highlight in the game yesterday, Phil, had to be the punting of Lewis Colbert in the play of our specialty teams.
Right.
They did a great job in the coverage, and Lewis averaged 47 point something.
His average.
He did a great job, and you know we're not playing to the same tempo that they are. Here's a nice rush and sack on the part of Andre Bruce, and took him out of touchdown. On fourth down, they kick a field goal and make it 24-0, and that's the score at the half. We haven't had a lot to cheer about on Auburn's side.
We'll be back in just a minute. I bet it'd be fun to get on one of those big houseboats and ride up the river there on an autumn afternoon to Neyland Stadium. I bet that's a nice way to go see a game.
It is if you win. Yeah. It's not much fun if you lose. I don't care how you get there.
Looking now at the Auburn band in their brand new uniforms. They were at the first Auburn game of the year.
We had a good crowd of Auburn people at Knoxville. Phil, we always do, and we certainly appreciate that support. You could feel them every time we did a little something that to give them a little hope. They responded, but we just didn't give them enough to help us any. I never did feel like the Tennessee crowd, even though it was loud, I think they felt like they had the game won, and they had a good time, but I didn't really notice it affecting us that much. You can see the Tennessee team was gang tackling and getting around the ball and having fun. And
Auburn defense held on Tennessee's first possession. This is Auburn's first drive.
Is Jeff throwing to Scott Bolton and picking up a nice first down and third down situation. We're throwing a screen pass here to Tommy A.G. and
another third down.
They do a great job of defending it, and we don't pick up the first down. Lewis Colbert comes in and hits a beauty. I don't know how far it was, 63 yards, whatever. Goes out of bounds at the 2-yard line, and we hold them here and get the ball back in good field position. Had a lot of missed tackles yesterday, Bill. I don't have a reason for it other than Tennessee was doing a good job and we were doing a poor job.
Third and two here.
The backs did run hard. There's a fine play right there by Pat Thomas and Harold Hallman and Andre Bruce and Gerald Williams. They have to punt to us. We get the ball out, I guess, around the 40-yard line.
Tennessee 39.
Right, we make a drive here, and I really felt like that this was a turning point of the game, Phil, and we take it down, and they hold us, and we don't make a play on fourth down. There's a nice run by Brent. Gets the ball down close to the 15-yard line. We're going to make a first down inside the 10.
Jackson has gone to the sidelines now with a twisted knee.
We got pretty good movement on the folks inside there. You can see the Tennessee folks, all the defensive backs there, getting 11 people to the football for sure.
That was a third and two at the 8 play. Now fourth third. And three coming here.
And we come up short. They obviously, again, it's not enough on Auburn's part, and it's a great defensive stand for Tennessee.
Hold them again. Last play of the third quarter.
Bobby on the option turns up inside and picks up 10 or 12 yards. And
now we're in the fourth quarter.
Option to Brent, pitches the ball. Good execution, gets another first down. Comes back, hits Freddie. Little turn in route, takes it down around the 10. Pulls the ball down here and runs it down to the 5. He's going to hit Kyle Collins. Well, we'll run a sweep here, I guess.
A.G. will score.
I think it's the next play he hits Kyle.
That's A.G. will score this one.
Tommy A.G. on just a fullback dive takes it in for the score. And, you know, it looked relatively easy then. And nothing's impossible. We go for 2 and don't make it. They come right back, and again, that's one of those beautiful passes to McGee, and he beat our defensive back, and he comes back and throws a little old soft touch fade route.
That's almost impossible to stop.
Right, and if it's executed, it's, you know, it's just tough. It just seemed like it. When we tried to throw the ball, they had somebody around ours, and when he threw it, they didn't have anybody around his. Bobby ends up having to throw that one away. In third down, we end up having a punt again. Lewis Colbert hits a beauty.
That's against the wind, too, there. That's 51 yards against
the coverage is down now. McGee fair catches it.
Here comes Tommy Powell, third.
He goes for all of it again to McGee. I guess he's having a good time. Well, I guess that's Swanson there.
Yeah.
He's trying to throw them all a long touchdown pass, I guess. So he goes to Swanson. Tommy Powell makes another great interception and a great run back. Sets up our second touchdown.
What a day he had.
Well, he plays like he practices. Mm-hmm. He practices that way every day, and if you develop good habits on the practice field, and you're going to have them when game time comes around. There's no secret to it. As Brent breaking the sprint draw all the way to the backside and takes it down to around the 8-yard line. Comes right back with a sweep again. Good blocking.
Steve Wallace, that is, man.
Jeff Parks and Ron Middleton and Steve Wallace. And we go for two and don't make it again. It's 24 to 12. They're going to come right back and answer that again. Well, I guess it's 30 to 12. And they come right back and throw another touchdown pass. I really believe Arthur Johnson right there caught the ball for him and take it away from him when he hit the ground.
Yeah.
But it was a great play on Tennessee's part again.
Tough running inside there.
Right, we're moving.
15 yards.
We're moving the football now, but it's too little too late. Bobby hits Scott Bolton on the sideline.
Gain of 7.
Good protection. Sprint draw again. Brent's good running inside. Right there where Brent gets hurt. Got a lot of folks hurt yesterday. I feel more than I can remember us getting hurt in the ball game in a long, long time. Tennessee deserves a lot of credit for that because they were doing the hitting. Jeff Parks on a nice reception.
Tough running there.
Tough
by
running
Curtis
by
Stewart.
Curtis Stewart. Lead down to our last tailback with Curtis. And I say last, he was our third tailback and a good one. Bobby comes out, hits Kyle Collins in the end zone for the touchdown. We go for two, run the option, pitch it to Curtis. And he takes it in for the 2-point and make it 38-20.
And the last
game's over.
3 minutes,
and
nobody.
I tell you, it was a mighty big win for Johnny Majors. I know that Johnny's been under some criticism in Knoxville, but he had a day in glory yesterday, and
he probably paid for those goalposts personally. Think?
Well, you know, this profession is a tough profession.
You're right.
Bill, and Johnny's been through his tough times at Tennessee, and we've been responsible for some of them.
That's right.
But yesterday was Tennessee's day in every respect, and based on what I saw yesterday, I think that Tennessee is going to win some football games for the rest of the year if they can keep all their folks healthy and that quarterback stays healthy.
We'll be back in just a minute. Well, what about your team, Coach?
Well, I think, first of all, Bill, you know, you don't, when you get beat like that, there's no excuse. And you look for the reasons why. I think it's going to take everything that we've got as a coaching staff, the leadership on our football team, the players, the fans, the students, everybody pulling together to get the football team off the ground and get ready to play a fine Ole Miss football team. It'll take the best, the very best that we've got to win the game.
All right, and we'll have it next week. It's a night game, by the way, Saturday. We'll see you next Sunday.
The Auburn football
got some of the best in Alabama. But we also have some teachers who just don't measure up. We've got to change that, and we can. Let's start by giving every teacher a test on basic skills. If they don't pass in 2 years, they cannot teach. Yes, that's tough, but it's the future of Alabama, of our children, we're talking about. I'm George McMillan. Next year, I'll be running for governor. Let's insist on excellence together.
WSFA Television, Montgomery.
Playing with the same pulse rate, the same heartbeat. Everybody playing for Auburn. Nobody worrying about anything else. That's what the game's all about, what you just played out there tonight. And that's what it's all about. I mean, and
You ought to never be satisfied with less than that. Never. And it really and truly started on the practice field last week. That's when it started. You practice perfect, you play, you practice hard, you develop the kind of habits that you can go out there and display those kind of things. I congratulate our coaching staff. You did a heck of a job getting it. You got to line up and do it again next week. I mean, Florida State's coming in here 4-0, right, fourth or fifth in the nation. They will be higher than anybody. They'll be higher than Tennessee was last week. I mean, that don't concern me. We can't do nothing about anybody but Auburn. Anybody but Auburn. So let's be sure that we're at our best.
The Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you by Colonial Bank, the bank in your future. Long's Electronics, tomorrow's electronics today. Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Alabama Farm Bureau Insurance. With Farm Bureau, you know you've got the best. And by Snapper, manufacturer of quality power lawn equipment.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review. Last night at Jordan-Hare Stadium, Auburn 41, Ole Miss nothing. Coach, I guess just a textbook example of how offense complements defense. I don't think we've seen a defensive performance like that since maybe the national champions back in 57.
Well, I wasn't at Auburn, then I did see them play one time and beat Georgia 6-0 in Columbus. But last night was certainly, I've never been around a football game like that before in my life. Not one that was turned out the way it did. I had no earthly idea, you know, going into the game that we would be as effective on defense as we were. I know that Ole Miss is a much better football team than they're going to get credit for, and we're probably not as good as what we'll get credit for. But it was a great team effort on both sides of the football, and Phil, it started last week in practice. Sunday when we started preparation and trying to get over the Tennessee game, our coaching staff getting together and the graduate assistants and the scout teams, and we carried it on the practice field last week and started, you know, actually the work started on the field Monday, and Tuesday we had you know, good work, but actually we didn't stay outside but about 45 minutes an hour. We had to go in the bubble and really confined us, but the tempo in practice Wednesday and Thursday night might have been the best practice that we've had at Auburn since I've been there as a team, where we had you could just feel it. I mean, it was the only thing that I was concerned about after Thursday night is that it's the most intense practice in shorts that I've ever seen. And the only thing I was concerned about was that maybe we might have been peaking too soon. So
obviously you didn't.
Well, it was a situation that our team needed that kind of feeling on the practice field so they could have something to tie to going into the game.
Okay, let's come back in just a minute and see that, but first into that post-game locker room.
We just had to have something good happen to us, and a game like this can't do anything but help us, I believe. If we approach next week as hard as we did last week, I think we should have a good season for the rest of the year.
We said right before the game that we're going to go right out and run right at them. And that's what we did, and we were successful with it.
How's it feel?
It's sore and tired right now, but I got tomorrow and Monday and Tuesday the rest of it.
37 carries, that's a lot.
I'll probably feel it tomorrow.
They go into you a lot in the clutch situations. You like that?
Yes, sir. I believe I'm working pretty well so far under the pressure. It's not getting to me. I know what I have to do on third down, and I look up and make sure I know the down and distance, and just been lucky so far.
Well, I think that this week we came out, we ran the ball real well to start with, so they really had to start keying their run, and when we do that, then we can throw the ball well too.
I was real happy for them, and I think I'll be happy for any quarterback that goes out there and do a good job, and I'm just hoping we'll build from that and that he'll get a little confidence, and that'll lead to a winning tradition around here.
Everybody was up, and we knew we had to do it, and we called it a conference
after one of Coach Dye meetings and got together.
You got a catch tonight.
Oh, yeah, it felt good. The first one of the season, you know. Our little smash route, the safety dropped back, and I just ran the zone post, and Pat put it right on the money.
You proud of that guy tonight?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, he played his heart out.
We were a little different type than last week, you know. We came out and played real hard up front and forced him to do a couple things he didn't want to do, you know, and he didn't have much time to throw the ball. So it was a pretty good day for us back there.
You need this going next week.
Yeah, we do. We need to play real great next week. I guess if we have a few more great practices, we have another great game.
We did good. We had a couple of quarterback sacks and stuff.
This quarterback you'll see next week will be a totally different kind of fella, though.
Right? Right. They're going to come out running and passing. They got a good overall offense, you know.
When I scored, our tackle and guard just came off and fired off on their tackle and just blew him in there.
You just hid behind him?
I just hid behind him and just went on in the end zone.
Two sacks. Tell me about it.
Well, it's a great feeling, you know. I've been waiting all year to get a sack, and I finally got it.
I think we reached all of our goals tonight as far as defensively is concerned, except for a turnover. We didn't get a turnover tonight, but we did reach all of our goals tonight.
Introduce me to this guy right down here that's getting up here. Yeah, bring him over here.
Oh,
tell me who he is.
This is Malcolm McQuarrie. He's a defensive tackle.
Yeah, he is, isn't he?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. How'd the defense do tonight, Malcolm?
I think great.
Come on. What you got on your face, Curtis?
Oh, a little grass on my face.
You get your nose rubbed in the grass?
Yeah.
A couple of times.
Two Montgomery guys here. You're starting to play more. How about it?
It felt much better than sitting on the sideline. I'm just waiting for my time to come. It came tonight, and I enjoy it. Yeah.
Andre, you playing more?
Well, yes. Yes.
Are you going to start a game? You going to start a game before this season's over?
Well, hopefully.
At Long's Electronics, we have just opened our new store in...
First night game at Jordan-Hare this year, a cool, brisk night, and you're about to see three great football players right there.
Well, I'll tell you what, they were great ones, and they meant an awful lot to us. Dow Altman and Pat Arrington and Randy Campbell. They came back for the game, and David King was back. David's on the injured reserve list at San Diego, man.
They picked a good one to come back and see, didn't
they? They start off right here.
Make
two first downs.
Yeah. Yeah.
And on a sweep, I think one might have been an isolation or something to the weak side. They broke outside and made a 7-8 yards, and then they come back on a sweep. It's over for them as far as the first down is concerned. Our defensive front played extremely well. Gerald Williams and Harold Hallman and Tracy Rocker and Nate Hill. Alex Duchot made a lot of play. That's Ben McCurdy making a nice play on the screen. That's Chuck Persons and Gerald White and
Johnny Lynn.
And this is a first and 20 play and a first and 18. I believe he made a first down. Tommy on a handoff right up the middle. And
was that guy
we've got,
ready?
Bo had a great night running the football. Of course, his night... And he had a great night, but I'm going to tell you one thing. He wasn't any better than his offensive line and those backs blocking for him.
No.
As Pat hitting Trey Gaines on a little old bootleg play that we put in for this ball game, and it worked extremely well as a sprint draw, and you're going to see some gaping holes in the offensive line. Is
third and seven here.
Ian Cowart, and goodness, what a block by Stacy Searles. I mean, I just... our offensive line has been getting better and getting better. Chris Knapp comes in and kicks a field goal, and we go out front 3-0. And an unusual situation last night in Lewis Colbert, our punter never punted a football. We really never got stopped. We stopped ourselves a couple of times. But as Willie Goodloe, goodness, look at him go. I wish Willie was wearing a blue jersey rather than that white one. He is a fine, fine little old young'un, and we looked at him hard and warned him and didn't know what to do. He's just so little. But they get out again, and there's pressure by Andre Bruce and finally sacked by Gerald Williams.
This was an important series there when
Absolutely.
They get the
Look at
back.
That play by Andre right there. I mean, he goes in there and gets a fullback, a quarterback, and he is getting better and having fun playing. And that excites me, I'll tell you that.
They get a good punt. Auburn starting on the 4-yard line.
We reestablishing the line of scrimmage there pretty good on a lot of things.
Look at that.
There's the isolation again, Tommy, and Steve Wallace. And
third and one right here.
Lott, Stacy Searles, and Ben Tamborella, and those two tight ends. Middleton and Parks are just fine throw and catch right there by Pat Washington and Freddie Wagan.
You're going to see a catch by Wagan that's unbelievable later. Well, you've already seen it.
Again, there's a fine block by Trey Gaines outside, out downfield, and Bo turns it into, I don't know, a 20, 25-yard run there.
His longest run of the night, 25 yards.
Come right back, and he's, it's a, you know, it's a game where...
Starting the second quarter.
Just about anything we called, our offensive line made a good play.
That was a fourth down play there, getting it.
Right, we had a... We really actually had a miscommunication there on that play, but the play was run right, but we shouldn't run it with that kind of motion. But we go out front 6-0, and early in the second quarter, Ole Miss is playing hard. They're playing a lot of young folks, and they're a good football team. As I told the coaches, I said, let's please don't kick it back to that guy again. So we kicked it off to the side, and we didn't have any problem with the kickoff after that. That's fine play. Gary Kelly is getting better and playing better. As Gerald Williams again. Gerald Robinson, Gary Kelly. There's Arthur Johnson and Jimmy Warren on the sideline. As Curtis Stewart comes in, Bo would run the ball, I guess, 15 or 16 times and along about here in the first quarter. And it was a great throw, and it would have been probably a touchdown. They get pass interference on it, but Ted hit really right between the numbers, and it was a great throw and a great catch. And that was a key third down play right there.
Third and 10.
Bill had hit Scott Bolton. Look at the blocking and the hold and running the football. And Scott Bolton is getting better and better. And those three little wideouts doing a super job.
Touchdown play again.
There's a Steve Wilson and Reggie. And
that line surge is remarkable.
Coming off of football and having fun, and you can just look at the effort and getting after the quarterback, and just here they get a offensive pass interference, it's good coverage by Kevin Porter, and Tommy Powell came across and I thought he'd hurt the officials. That's a fine play by Alex Duchamp. Edward Phillips. Right there, we just nobody to throw to. It's swarming around the quarterback, Ben McCurdy and Edward Phillips. I think our coaches again did a great job with the game plan. And Bo just, what we did was absolutely basic. It wasn't anything fancy about it, just good old fashioned football.
PG with
blocking,
a block on the corner.
Blocking.
There.
And
38 carries.
Running inside and running outside. And
240 yards for Bo Jackson.
Look at that. Look at Tommy Powell, AG. That's it. That offensive line come off the football.
Reggie Ware, designated short yardage. Man.
I don't know whether we want to advertise that or
not.
I think people's going to get the idea. There's another sack by Gerald Robinson, and he's got some company back there. I don't know who all that was back there, Nate.
Watch Tommy Powell. Oh, my, he came along.
Tommy was lined up. Yeah, he's lined up in a middle row of defense, really, in a long yard situation. They ran the draw, and Tommy comes from center field and makes a play.
20-0 at the half. We'll be back.
We have University feature. Carl Velker has a look at the great Auburn band.
The Auburn Marching Band has always been a visible part of football Saturdays, but this fall, the band has a new look. Thanks to an Auburn Generations Fund gift from longtime Auburn benefactor Jimmy Goodwin of Birmingham, the band has newly styled uniforms for the first time in 30 years. The old flat-top hat has given way to a shako with a plume, and band director Johnny Vinson says the rest of the uniform has changed, too.
Yeah, the new uniform is a West Point-style uniform, a short coat in the front with tails in the back, and a shako hat with a plume. It's a newer, brighter, more contemporary style than the old uniforms we've had for so long. The last three sets of uniforms we've had, which have lasted 30 years, 10 years each, have been essentially the same style, double-breasted blazer with a flat-top hat. So this is really the first new look for the Auburn band in 30 years.
Rounding out the band's new look this fall is a new flag corps, all designed to give the Auburn University Marching Band even more razzle-dazzle than ever before.
The only thing that could have made your night more complete was to see that halftime show. I'm sorry.
Well, Sue, I got a good scouting report from Sue. She said it was the best halftime show that she'd ever seen, bowl games, football games, anywhere.
Auburn and, singers and the band and fireworks.
Sue, if you know Sue like I do, she's doesn't give out compliments very easily.
She was ready for a good night. She didn't have such a good night last week, Coach. She deserved one.
Well, I tell you, it was a good night. I want you to look at here now. That band that you just saw the feature on and they had the fireworks, and I could hear that in the dressing room. I didn't know what was going on out there. I said, here we are playing pretty good. We're going to get invaded before we get it over with. But it...
this is the finish of it.
That is absolutely great. And that band is important to the emotions.
330 of those people.
The band is important to the emotions on that field and the emotions in the stand. I can tell you that. That's and we had plenty of emotions on the sideline last night. It was a great feeling just to
open up with a good drive in second half.
Unity, and I don't know if that was a third down play or not, but it was coming back to Saturday. We take the ball. This is probably the finest opening half drive that we've had in a long, long time. Take the ball and drive it, 74, 5 yards or 80 yards
start
or whatever.
Start at 26 and go all the way.
84 yards or 74 yards. And just methodically take it down there. Pat makes us another key play here, and I believe that was third and
four.
Whatever, but come back with a sprint draw here, and Bo makes a nice run down to around the 12. And
that was third and four.
That offensive line is coming off of football there. Stacy Searles and Ian Cowart just getting their folks back. Ben Tamarella, Jeff Lott, Steve Wallace just coming and having fun. And I mean, it's good pressure on the quarterback. Tracy Rocker and Gerald Robinson making the play, and their punter, Trey Gaines, did a great job of getting the ball fielded last night. I wish we could have got a long punt return. We worked extremely hard on the punting game, the kicking game last week. You can see old Trey, he is trying to get it upfield. Mm-hmm. We got some folks trying to make blocks.
Watch this one coming,
but,
then.
I guess that, been watching this guy. He'd been squatting on everything that we were doing, and that is an unbelievable catch right there. You know, I think it would be more remarkable, really, if it wasn't Freddie. It's not too remarkable, because I've seen him make catches like that before. I saw him make catches like that in high school, he has got the most, every fiber in his body concentrates on catching the football, and that's just a poor throw right there. Yeah, I don't know what Pat was thinking about. I think he thought maybe Jeff was going to run in that open spot, and I know he didn't think it. Yeah, I think he was about halfway trying to throw the ball away. But anyway, it was a turnover, and we come right back and get the ball back as Andre Bruce and Shan Morris. That's a play that we had worked hard on. They knew they were going to try to throw it deep down the middle against too deep coverage. And again, we got pressure. And there's Ron Stallworth makes a sack on the quarterback, and Ron is getting better and better.
Going the other way. They did not make a first down after the first
Jim,
two.
Jim Thompson in that offensive center, and we had the opportunity to play a lot of folks last night. And that was we had intentions to do that going in, and Jim, of course, is coming off of his knee being scoped. Here again, you can see Thomas getting one.
Another third down conversion. 9 of 13 third down conversions. That's remarkable.
It's Pat hitting Ron Middleton. Ron has been kind of gimpy with his feet and ankles, and wasn't sure if he's going to be able to play and how much, but I tell you, he is a competitor and a great leader for us.
Fourth quarter.
As you can see, this reestablished the line of scrimmage and running behind Tommy and Reggie Ware.
Number 34 goes to the sidelines after that. He's had a pretty good workout.
Well, he needs to rest a little. There's Walter Reed sitting there with Pat Washington on the sideline. They come back, and you know, they dropped two or three passes last night, but there was somebody close to all of them. There's Nate Hill. Nate, you saw talking about that sack, and have Benji Rowland, big freshman nose guard from over in Eastman, Georgia. Benji's getting better and better every week. As
their next series coming here.
Bingo. Right there. Carlo Cheatham.
All right.
Carlo's a freshman, hadn't played any, but he's getting better and better in practice each week. Brian Smith over in Opelika. As Jonathan Robinson, that's got good coverage on the guy. We is an excellent play right here on the part of Kevin Porter. Kevin is very talented, getting better each week, and going to be a great, great cornerback.
Jeff Berger?
And Lawyer Tillman. Jeff Berger comes in for two drives here now, and he's hit Lawyer on one side and Freddie on the other. Just we're throwing enough just to keep the ball moving right here and maintain the ball. And as Lee Mark Sellers and Walter Reeves and Kyle Collins running the ball on the sweep. As Trey Gaines. I tell you, that's the reason we threw that interception a while ago. We were really trying to get Kyle, throw the ball to Kyle in that situation. And as Brent Gilbert gets on the ball, and we got a Brent Gilbert and Vincent Jones and Stacy Dunn, and goodness, is there anybody else out there that I can see? And Curtis Stewart takes it in for the touchdown. It's a nice drive for that group of youngsters right there. And Rob Shula might have been out there. Rob has been one of our captains and has been a very, very consistent football player for us all fall and a great leader for us. And
happy night.
It was. And
Jordan here.
It was. And a situation like that, Phil, I was extremely proud of our coaches and players and fans and everybody connected with it. But I'm also, you got to feel for that guy on the other side. And he's got some good days in front of him, though.
We'll be back in just a minute.
Here's a postcard.
Auburn, Florida State, next week for you at this time. Thank you.
Montgomery.
Lord, I thank you for our coaches and the leadership that they've displayed and the wisdom that they've had in guidance. Lord, help us not to stop now. Help us to keep going and going. In your precious Son, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
To go for it, man. I mean, we don't have good players or great players everywhere, but we got enough great players, and we got enough of them other kind that are fighting their guts out every Saturday now. That you ought to go for it.
Right.
Now the thing about it is that you've had two great victories in a row, two great ones in a row. I mean, great victories. And we're gonna be playing a 6-1 football team next week, on Atlanta. AstroTurf, there's going to be a lot of conversation about that. I don't care if we play out there in the parking lot in the gravel. It don't make any difference. Here's a plan. I mean, we need to back off a week. We need to back off a week and regroup. But I can't do it. I mean, I can do it, and I'm going to do it. But if you take it the wrong way, it's going to hurt you. You're going to go backwards. You're going to go backwards. But if you take it the right way and you concentrate on your schemes and your game plan and you study your guy and you work on getting your body well and feeling good and speed and quickness and execution, all those things, I mean, it can be a good week for us. It can be a week that we can actually get better and be quicker on that turf when we get to Atlanta.
The Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you by Colonial Bank, the bank in your future. Long's Electronics, tomorrow's electronics today. Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Alabama Farm Bureau Insurance. With Farm Bureau, you know you've got the best. And by Snapper, manufacturer of quality power lawn equipment.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review, a wilder fourth quarter you'll never see at Jordan-Hare. Auburn 59, Florida State 27. Coach, remarkable.
Well,
still, I never had any idea it would turn out like that. I was scared to death all week long and knew we were in a catch-up pattern as far as preparation is concerned and against an outstanding Florida State football team. And the game started out just exactly like we expected. We knew that they'd have an excellent plan and be well prepared, and they were, and they played hard. They did everything we expected them to do. And I've got to be proud of our coaching staff and the job that they did and the leadership on our football team and all the players and the guys on the scout teams and graduate assistants that went about getting our plan in preparation and work for the 3 or 4 days in preparation to get ready to play Florida State. And it was a big, big win for us. There's no question about it. It was one that was turned out to be a very emotional win. Like all of the Florida State games, excuse me, have been. But it was one I hope that we came a little closer together as a football team, and I think that if we can take the last couple of weeks and learn from it and grow from it and add a little more execution, not as penalties, eliminate some mistakes defensively, then this football team can be, I think, very good if we can stay free of injury.
Okay, let's go into the locker room now and first sing happy birthday to Pat Washington.
Happy birthday!
It was just there. The tight end and Tommy, they walled off the linebackers, and everybody else just got jammed up in there. And I just took my time, and I finally found the crack, and I went through. Thank you.
Pat made the play on the second play, and our line did, because when I rounded the corner, I think there's 4 or 5 guys on the inside of me for us blocking. And but Pat made the play because he was almost on the ground and just handed the ball to me right before he fell.
Hey, you guys get dumped on a lot. You did some dumping today, didn't you?
Yeah. You know, I guess we got kind of got criticized, you know, a lot after Tennessee, and I guess that was our turning point, you know, after Tennessee to come out and play well.
Well, you're an old Georgia boy going to Atlanta next week. That's exciting to you?
Well, I'm looking forward to it, but this week's practice will determine how I do in Atlanta.
And I found out that Tracy Rocker hit the quarterback, and the ball popped up. And as I hit it across to go to the quarterback, the ball just sort of landed in my hand and hit it for the goal line.
Have you ever scored before?
No, sir.
Success has been a while in coming. How do you feel?
Well, it just makes it that much more valuable. You cherish it more.
Hi.
What a crowd at Jordan-Hare Stadium, 75,000.
Well, it was a hot day, Phil.
Those mamas and papas.
It was not what you would call a good day for football because it was just too hot. But if you live in the South, you're going to have to play in the heat. And we used to it, Florida State's used to it, and so it didn't bother either one of us, I don't guess. So they had some players get tired and hot, and we did too.
That was number 88.
We take this first one in, Phil, and it was a great drive to wait to start to open the ball game, but it didn't take Florida State long to come back either. We opened the game with a sweep to Bo, and he picks up about 8 yards, and we just go right on and make another first down. Phil, one thing that, you know, Bo was making, rushing for nearly a 200-yard average, and here's the first great run right here. He just broke 2 tackles and then accelerated and made this last guy miss him and got in the end zone. I think it was 53 yards for a touchdown. Mm-hmm. But our offensive line and our 2 tight ends, look at Jeff Parks and Tommy Agee right there. Now, Bo is doing his thing, too. Don't think he's not. But those other guys are doing theirs, too. Jeff Parks and Ron Middleton and Lee Mark Sellers, when he's in that tight end, Steve Wallace and Stacy Searles and Jeff Lott and Steve Wilson and Ben Tamborella and Ian Cowart. They come right out with that razzle-dazzle.
Boy, don't
reverse
they.
Pass. Kevin Porter plays it perfect. And it doesn't take them long to move the football either. They have a great play. Watch Tracy Rocker there. He's trailing and just keep coming.
There he is.
Makes a play.
He's really
along
come on.
Along with Edward Phillips. I hope Edward Phillips played good at, and we sure need for that middle linebacker to come through for us. That was Pat Thomas, knock that little quick pass down, and they come with the reverse again.
They really know how to pressure a defense, don't they? They really make you cover the field.
They are the best at running reverses, and of course we worked on them all week long. We talked about them. We called those reverses out there yesterday before they ran them, and still it's hard to defend them. Lewis got the kick a couple of times yesterday. I think averaged 43 yards a punt, and we were concerned about them blocking kicks. Our specialty teams, I think, did an outstanding job yesterday. Maybe one kickoff return we didn't look too good on, but overall, we're not tackling as good as we need to as a defensive football team right now. Of course, Florida State's got some backs that will make you miss, as Harold Hallman, and Harold didn't practice most of the week with a sprained ankle, but it looked like in the game that he played mighty well, came up with some big plays in the game.
Game does not look good at this point for Auburn.
Well, it's like it's been, Phil. We're going to move the football. They're going to move it. They are playing hard. They are a little better football team on defense, I think, than they have been. It's fine play right there by Kevin Porter and Tracy Rocker. Come back, and they faked a sweep. And Tommy Powell and Ben McCurdy and, I don't know, Gerald Williams, I guess. As we stop them here, and they miss a field goal. Mm-hmm. And it was a big play. There's a little quarterback, McManus, that I think it was about this time that they took him out of the ballgame. He said he was dizzy, and I hate that he was dizzy, but it was fine with me that he left the game.
But
we're coming back right here. And, you know, Pat said that, I think after the game, said he was actually had butterflies up through the middle way of the first quarter, and I can understand that with the game being like it is, but that was not a good throw. And
Eric Williams.
He really came back and played it really well in the second half, but he was not too good on those two throws right there. But we come back, and we're going to take this one down for the touchdown. And Bo making his classic sweep pass on our basketball players.
First and 10 at the 45.
Enjoying the football game. We're going to enjoy some of those basketball games before the year's over. As Brent Fullwood making a 25-yard run on the sprint draw, cut it to the backside. And
that was a big play, too. That really excited people.
It was a big play, and one that we needed.
Fourth down here. Bo over the top for the first down.
We went on fourth down several times yesterday and went one time and didn't get it. And
third and five here.
A big play on the option. Pat turns up inside and I think makes 10 or 12 yards on the play and gets it on down, and Reggie Ware is going to score from the 1 foot line or 1 yard line.
Here he comes.
Reggie got hurt a little bit yesterday, and Tommy A.G. looked like he'd been in a prize fight after the ball game.
He was beat to death, wasn't he? Oh, my. What a big play he made with that long run to get
this
off.
This is a big play
again
on that part. Bryant, the fine split receiver, got great speed. We had good coverage on him, and it was just didn't finish the coverage off. Great hit and lick right there by Edward Phillips, the middle linebacker, on the little Holloman coming inside. That's another outstanding play by Andre Bruce and Kevin Porter and Gerald Williams, and they make this field goal.
It's kind of a victory when you hold those guys to a field goal.
We've got some young folks that are playing better and better each week for us on defense.
Look at Bo lay this ball over that boundary, over that marker.
I think Bo really, he gained 176 yards yesterday. Here's a great play right here. I really think, and a great call too. On the reverse, you got Jeff Lockwatch, Jeff, and Randy Stokes downfield. Got those two big linemen 50 yards downfield in front of the reverse. And we've been working on this thing a couple of weeks, and I know our fans are glad to see us do something a little different besides toss it back at a bow. And we got a couple more wrinkles that we're gonna run sometime when we got a game won. Oh, man, that was a big play for us right there. And it swapped into the field for us, and we got down and tied the ball game 17-17 going into half. And kind of the way Florida State had moved the football and the way we moved it, I felt like we were ahead 17-17.
We'll be back in just a minute.
Our university feature today deals with the nationally known College of Engineering at Auburn. Carl Velker reporting.
The Auburn Engineering Outreach Program offers graduate-level, state-of-the-art courses in engineering disciplines on videotape so that engineers can update their training at the work site rather than traveling to the university campus. Through this video-based program, off-campus students can receive the same quality instruction offered to on-campus students in the College of Engineering.
Off-campus students follow basically the same schedule as our on-campus students, although they lag behind about a day or two because of the mailing process. We're making every effort to make this a quality program, the same quality as our on-campus program. The entrance and degree requirements are identical to those for our on-campus students.
And faculty members teaching these video-based courses even publish telephone hours during which off-campus students may call to ask questions. The Engineering Outreach Program, offering quality off-campus instruction for the people of Alabama and the South.
Pat Dye, this team, while having played two nationally ranked teams, had not allowed a touchdown in the second half for four games. I'm sure you pointed that out.
Well, we did, and of course the thing, I really, at the half, Phil, I challenged our football players because it was hot, and we did have some tired players. Mm-hmm. But I also knew that we had some depth and that we had some guys that were playing hard, and it was Gary Kelly and Ben McCurdy and Nate Hill and
watch Gerald get up and get to that guy.
That's a big play. I tell you that. In fairness to the quarterback, several of the passes that were intercepted were tipped, mm-hmm. and that was one of them right there. That pass, you know, could have been caught. If it was my receiver, I'd say it should have been caught. As Lawyer Tillman, Lawyer's getting better every week, and as Pat really has a fine second half right here, throwing the football and running the team. A fine pass and catch to Freddie Wagan, and comes back and hits Trey Gaines here. Again, Trey made a great catch. That guy was all over his back, and Trey makes a run here without
his head. Is this a run or is this a run?
This is, that guy right there, he has that kind of determination and that kind of talent to make those kind of runs, and he is having a good time playing. I think he was excited about playing because I really didn't know whether he was going to be able to play or not. He hadn't practiced all week, and his knee is swelling up, and we're not sure what's wrong with it. And I think he's concerned about it, too. But Florida State, they just keep on coming back, and as a near interception on the part of Jimmy Warren.
He had a couple.
Right, watch this right here with Trey Gaines, and you might have saw it yesterday on television, but loses his hat right there. And the little old guy just keeps on running. That guy right there tried to hit him without his headgear. But I think the our players on the sideline saw him running and getting hit and getting tackled. This is a big one here.
That kind of ignited everybody on the sideline.
Well, that right there. I think the run that Trey had got everybody excited, sitting there looking at that guy fighting for yardage without a headgear. And then people trying to kill him out there. And then Bo goes in and makes this run. And at this time, the momentum in the game just really changed our way. Because Florida State, they come right back and do what they
had. Sure do. They make a 10-point
run. What they
run.
Had to do to get back in it. Drop my mic here a second.
That's all right, Coach. We'll forgive you.
All right. There's Holloman again. I don't believe you couldn't hem him up in a phone booth. I tell you,
they do have talent.
There's a good run on by that guy. Russ Carrick and Tommy Powell finally make a tackle on the screen. They got fourth and two, and they fool us and go for it and make it, and here comes on the reverse again. There's a missed tackle, and, ordinarily you just chew a guy out about missing no tackle, but I tell you, I don't know.
Look at the speed of Tony Smith.
They did a great job running sweep right there.
We didn't have that.
We didn't do a very good job of defending it, and they go ahead and score, and they make it, 24-31?
Mm-hmm.
There's a guy that had a big day yesterday also. Tommy A.G., he has them every day, though.
His run was really key in this game. The reason we didn't have that fourth down play, Coach, is because nobody had it. Everybody in every camera was faked out on that.
Is that right?
It was so good.
Well, we do a good job of getting the ball back out to midfield, and then great coverage right here. That guy is very dangerous. He's a freshman and going to be a great player. Andre Bruce and Chip Powell and Alex Ferlin and Pat Moat. As Brian Smith, Brian has a big play in the ball game, and the great interception right here on the part of Jimmy Warren, and
we get a blocking below the waist right here that nullified a great return. We'd have had the ball about the 18-yard line going in, but the clipping call got it back out to, what, the 30?
Mm-hmm.
We take it in anyway. Bo makes a nice run, and Pat does a good job of executing the option, getting it pitched. And is this where we don't make it in?
Right.
We don't make it on fourth down. I tell you, I was so confident that we would make it. We had third and one, and then fourth and one, and we hadn't been stopped like that. And we made a poor decision on the first call. We ran in at the best defensive player they got with the fullback, and then the next time we just didn't make it, or we didn't get a good spot on it. If you did make it, regardless, you ought to make it to where it's not a question. But anyway, we run the quarterback around, get him out of bounds, and they're going to kick a field goal.
And get within four. Critical point in the game now in Auburn's next series.
It is. I mean, it's gotten back to where it's close again. And I'm knowing that I should have kicked that field goal now. But Tommy Agee shuts the door on him right here. A great cut at the line of scrimmage. The offensive line to Steve Wallace and I guess Jeff Lott or Steve Wilson. Jeff Lott's in that guard. Look at Jeff Parks walled off the end. Tommy splits the two defensive backs right there, and it's a foot race, and the guy from the backside runs him down at the 10 or 12 yard line.
From here on, folks, it gets wild and crazy.
Pat Washington does a great job. Pat does a great job right there with the handling the pressure. He didn't want to run the play because he knew we were going to get the blitz, and there's a strong safety around his legs, and he was scared to pitch it, and finally ends up just handing it to Freddie. But the only thing that could hurt us right here was a turnover. Mm-hmm. But we knew it would be there if we could get it off. So here they come back again. Tip pass, picked off by Kevin Porter. He runs it into the end zone for a touchdown.
Look at it again.
There's pressure right there by Gerald Robinson and I guess Nate Hill and and Kevin Tommy Porter. Powell, that's two fine football players right there that are playing great for us. And Kevin Porter, as Brian Smith and Ron Stallworth picks it off, goes 22 yards for the touchdown. Big Brian Smith, the big freshman from Opelika, goes by and does a great job, comes back, hits him. Ron Stallworth picks it off and runs it in.
Doesn't look like 34, does he?
Untouched.
He's getting the job.
Well, I am thrilled to death to see some of these youngsters playing and getting better each week. And they come back and they fumble it, and Russ Carricker gets on it for. You know, the thing just seemed like the dam just broke here.
Mm-hmm.
As Jeff Berger at quarterback pitches back to Curtis Stewart, and Curtis makes a nice run for 8-9 yards. We hand it to Demetrius Street. And Demetrius fights his way into the end zone.
Demetrius had a good block on the previous play, too.
As Eric Floyd, it was the last 5 minutes of the game. It was a lot of fun. Still, it was. Our football team has grown closer together. There's no question that they are enjoying playing, and they've become, there's more unity, and they're just playing more of the things that championship teams are made of than we did certainly early in the season. Now, I think what we need to do is we need to take that fun and that intensity and that enthusiasm and get it refined where our execution is a little sharper. Our defensive, we're not making the mistakes defensively that we made yesterday to hurt us. If we can line up and not make those critical errors and make people line up and beat us, because they're better than we are, then we have got a chance to be a good football team.
We'll be back in just a minute.
Another flower catalog, another gardening magazine, and another car insurance premium.
It's time we called Farm Bureau Insurance to compare rates.
We've got a car.
Game next week, Grant Field, Atlanta, the artificial turf, CBS National Television, and a tough opponent.
Well, Georgia Tech is, I guess I'd say 6-1 earlier, but I guess they're, what, 4-1, 5-1? There's no doubt that they've got an outstanding football team, and they've already beaten some good teams. We'll have to play with the same kind of level of intensity that we played the last couple of weeks, plus eliminate some of the mistakes. And we need to go into Atlanta, and if we got any question about playing on artificial turf, we need to get rid of it, because both teams are playing on the same surface. I think that this week in practice, we'll spend more time on artificial turf, particularly tackling and doing some of the things that you do at a, you know, it takes playing a different speed and football position, and I think that we probably need that.
Win on the road, too. And we'll have it for you next week right here. Thank you. We'll see you next Sunday.
Amazing stories.
It's a family affair, and that's all. It was a team win. We look at the films, and we're going to see that we probably could have done a lot better job coaching. You probably could have done a lot better job playing. There's a lot of areas for improvement going into next week. You got to win these kind men to have a championship team. You got to win these kind to grow a little. And I really and truly am glad that you were behind against a good football team and had to come from behind in the second half.
The Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you by Colonial Bank, the bank.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review. Character builder at Grant Field yesterday, Auburn 17, Georgia Tech 14. I would say in a word, Coach, courageous on the part of the Auburn defense.
Well, it was an exciting football game, to say the least. It was a game that Georgia Tech didn't surprise me. I think I did a poor job of getting our players prepared to play against the kind of football team we played against yesterday. But they're a good football team. And we weren't quite on top of our game at the beginning. And Georgia Tech was having all the fun and carrying the fight to us for a half. And we came back the second half, and we played much better defensively. Offensively, we did what we had to do to win the football game.
This is the kind of game you like, isn't it? These old gut check.
Well, I think that it's important. You're going to have to play them. And regardless of whether you want to play them or not, you got to play these kind, and you got to, you know, if you're going to have a kind of season you want to have, you got to win them. And I know that in 83, the year we went 11-1, we had about five or six of these. Mm-hmm. Had one in Atlanta, as a matter of fact. Well, the same kind of thing happened. We just didn't score as many points in the second half yesterday as we did in 83. But the thing that is important is that you win them. We've got what the experts consider the fourth toughest schedule in the country. Coming off of the kind of emotional wins that we've had the last 2 weeks, you got to have some letdown. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, our kids are human too. Yeah. And I was worried about it. And I knew we had a lot of people that didn't work last week and didn't practice. It was a great win for us, and one that kids will remember a long time. And
a lot of fans, too.
Now we got to
go back to work and get ready to play Mississippi State.
Let's go into the post-game locker room.
How about the turf?
Turf is not natural grass.
But as turf goes, it wasn't too bad.
Turf goes, yes, it wasn't too bad. It's hard, and we just got to get used to playing on it.
Were you tired on the long run? You looked tired before you made it.
Oh, the heat out there on that turf, it's really tough. And one long run like that could put you out for about seven or eight plays on down the road. It really takes a whole lot out of you.
Hey, coming from behind like this and defending on the defense, is it good for this team?
Yes, it's very good. You know, in order to be a good football team, you're going to have to come from behind and win the close game.
Fourth down plays, were you watching from the sideline?
Well, yes, I was watching our defense. I was praying that they stop them, and they did it. They did a great job. We got to credit this game for our defense, and the offense got to pull one off next week.
The second half, the kids rose to the occasion on those two fourth and ones. And,
that's Benji Rowland in there a lot.
He did. He's played well the last 2 weeks, and I told him I'm going to play him. So he got in there, and I'm sure he held his own. I'll have to look at the film and see.
I bet he feels good.
I know he does. I think we all do, Phil.
It was sweet. You find yourself playing in a big game. How about it?
Yes. It was nice coming back to Georgia and getting the vigor out of it.
How about this pup, Benji Rowland, huh?
Oh, that little pup's come along good. He's turned into a mean dog now.
You see what kind of people you lined up with, and they'll go for it.
You know them a little better now.
You know them a little better, right?
Hey, maybe you guys need to start a black watch. What do you say?
No. I don't think so. On the black watch, we got 11 people. I like to have all 11 people in the black watch club. I like that.
You talk to your daddy today?
He came to the hotel last night and I talked to him.
Mm-hmm. Wonder how he feels now. This must be tough on the old boy.
I'm sure he was glad it was a close game, but I think he was cheering for me. I hope so.
George Tech's got a good team. I think it was a little bit that we weren't ready to play like we have been, and it was a little bit that they were better than we thought they were.
You got on a fumble, didn't you?
Yeah, I was blocking my man, and it just popped loose. I thought the play was dead, really. I seen that ball, and they teach us to jump on the ball, and I jumped on it.
Bo is human after all. He can fumble every once in a while, can't he?
He's part human. Not all the way.
Okay, Grant Field, Atlanta, big crowd. Maybe.
A lot of Georgia Tech folks. That's right. The biggest Georgia Tech crowd that we've seen at Grant Field since we've been going over there.
May have been 40% Auburn, though. It was a big crowd.
Dewberry, the little quarterback, does a good job, and they come out at it. Surprised me, really, that they came out and tried to throw the ball the first three times they had it, the first three plays of the game. And
he was throwing high, too.
Right, he was a little off with his passing. We hold him, and they kicked to us, and we were not at, the top of the game. Have a great return by Trey Gaines right here. The defense, we've been coming close to getting one of those things run back all year long, and Trey can do it if we just give him the help he needs. We do a couple of different things offensively, and Georgia Tech runs a lot of different looks up front, and it's hard to really get a pattern on what to call and what to run. And
on this play, Bo becomes Auburn's all-time leading ground gainer, going past James Brooks, 3,523 yards.
That was a kind of short, insignificant-looking run, but he's had some spectacular ones to get him there, I can assure you, and he's got one coming up in this film. Lewis Colbert did a great job of punting yesterday. He, I think, averaged 40 yards, which was 7-8 yards under his average, but he kicked it out at the 7, the 14, and had another one that should have been downed at the one. Mm-hmm. You're going to see our defense, for the most part, we played extremely well yesterday. Gerald Robinson make a nice play on that quarterback.
Third and eight, they get a draw going here.
It looks like Edward Phillips played much better. This is the play that's hurt us over the years, and we just, there's Arthur Johnson and Edward Phillips, like Arthur Johnson was running the football a lot. It was a great play by Andre Bruce. A calls fumble. Gerald Williams comes up with it. Or who? I thought it was Gerald Williams.
I think it was.
It's Gerald Williams, and of course, Tommy Powell's there. Nate Hill's close. Handoff up inside to Tommy A.G., and we just can't get anything consistent going the first half.
Twice on turnovers, we didn't get points, Coach.
That's
and we're better than that on offense. So, still, I'm still very disappointed at our passing game. We had, we were 2 for 10, had 3 dropped and 1 intercepted, and if we don't get a better passing game, then it's going to hurt us down the line.
You like that little running back there, don't you?
Yeah, I do. And that was a fine play by Ben McCurdy, and Ben been hurt all week. Had a great play by Tracy Rocker. And we just had, you know, as a team, I think that defensively we played well, and had some individuals that played really well.
Replay of the last play there.
It's Dewberry going back to pass, and this is a play that they hurt us with right here that we had worked on and worked on and worked on. It's a play they hurt us with last year. They hurt us on it twice yesterday. And I'm just glad they didn't throw it more.
Starting the second quarter, it's the same drive now as they go in.
They come
the
in there. They come in there, and it's a, really an illegal pick on our linebacker, but it's hard to call and hard to see. And they get the touchdown, and Brent Fullwood makes a nice return. And of course, this is a sign of a great football team right here. We come right back and answer the call, and Brent gets it out to the 37, 38 yard line, and
35.
Bo comes right back right here and makes an excellent run. Stepped out of bounds right there. And you can see Tech's got a lot of folks around the ball. They're a football team that pursues well. They've got great athletes, and they're doing a terrific job of coaching and playing, and they're a good football team. Just pat on the, just pulling it down and running it, and I think he's looking more to defenders, and it's a great run by Bo right here. And there's one
Look
of the
that. Mercy.
One of the black watch guys that
those guys with the black stripe on the helmets are the black watchers. There are 6 of them.
Oh goodness, did you see Yan Cow and that offensive line come off the football, Stacy Searles, and watch this right here. Ben Tamarella, you could drive a transfer truck through there. Tommy and Bo like to see those kind of holes there. That makes life easy for
they
them.
They can't hit enough. This
fine play by Arthur Johnson, and has Edward Phillips there again, and Gerald Robinson, and Pat Thomas. And Pat Thomas, a great play right here. Our coaches came up with a little blitz that did a great job for us yesterday, and particularly in the second half, we come up with some big plays in third down situations where we got somebody clean on the quarterback and really made a difference in the ball game.
They get it to the 1 on Snow's punt and backs Auburn up.
Pat comes out with a bootleg here and makes a big gain for us. And getting the ball off the goal line. Right here, Jeff Lott backs up into him and knocks the ball out of his hand.
So Auburn is backed
up on
4th
and long. We didn't have what you would call one of our better days offensively yesterday. We kind of struggled all day. Just thank goodness that Bo had a great day and that we were physical enough to make some things happen with our running game. Good coverage on the punt. We haven't done a very good job of covering kickoffs. I don't know if we got to change people on it or what, but they're going to take this one in to score. This is a great play on their part, and Jimmy should have come a little hard. He waited for the ball and just going to let it come to him instead of attacking the football. And the guy catches it at the 2-yard line, and they take him a couple of plays, but they get it in right there. So they go out 14-7, and we come back, take the ball down the length of the field and get it down there close and throw an interception right before half. And
Auburn's only turnover, though.
I want to turn over in the game. That was the difference in the game, Phil. That we turned it over once, they turned it over twice, and you can just about bet that
in a close game.
In a close game, that's going to make a difference.
We'll be back in just a minute.
Very much in doubt. 14-7, Georgia Tech leading at the half. Coach, this let me ask you something about Bo Jackson. It's very evident when a game starts that the 11 guys on the other side are dedicated to getting after that guy.
Well, what
how does it look to you?
Well, it's got to be, you know, it's got to be, I mean, that's the way it is. And, you know, they feel if they can get to, if they can get to Bo, then they've, you know, then they've stopped you. Mm-hmm. What makes your motor run?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
But we've got a fine offensive line.
It makes them more dedicated.
Our tight ends, Jeff Parks and Middleton and Steve Wallace and Stacy Searles and Yan Cowart and Ben Tamarella and Steve Wilson and Lott and Shula and Stokes and Floyd and all those guys that play in there. I mean, they're personal protectors. Great play right there by Tommy Powell, and I really think that play had a lot to do with that coming to the game because...
Stopped him on the first drive.
Right, and they weren't near willing to throw that thing after that. Mm-hmm. Now look at that right there. You know, we got some calls yesterday that might have been justified, but it wasn't consistent. Yeah. That's not the first guy that has hit bow late this year, though.
It really takes a lot of pounding.
But we take it down and miss a field goal, and in a game like this, Phil, the only thing that concerned me is if you can play defense. I mean, you got to play defense in these kind of games on the road, and our kid rolls to the cage.
Third and two right here.
Nate Hill and good pressure. Now, that right there takes something out of the quarterback, too. Edward Phillips and Arthur Johnson hit him just as he threw the ball, and a great save by Kevin Porter.
Classic defense right there. Here's Auburn's drive for a field goal.
That's thrown to Freddie Wagan. Picks up, I think, 11 yards. Keeps on the bootleg here. He picks up about 10.
One of those black watchers there you ran through, Coach.
that kid's got a big kick out of that. Brent Fullwood makes a nice play, and Brent's doing a great job when he comes in the game. He's giving us big plays, and he comes right back with another big run and gets the ball down in there close. And at this time in the ball game right now, Bo was tired, and we might have made a mistake. We put him back in the ball game. It might have been a mistake to put him back in there, but heck, you never know. We kick a field goal, and it's 10-14. And look at Gerald Williams and Kevin Porter and
still climbing uphill.
Edward Phillips, and there's another great pressure on the quarterback, and there's Russ Carrick and Edward Phillips again. And man, I'm telling you, it excites me to see that number 46 around the ball, because like I mentioned the other day, we need so bad for him to be a football player.
That was a third down five play. That was a quarterback draw that never
quarterback materialized. Quarterback draw, Tracy Rocker and Pat Thomas, big plays. Here comes Bowen, just a little old 4 or 5 yard play.
Fourth quarter now, here's the run.
He's running up in that briar patch, I tell you.
Third and six.
Great play by Tommy A.G. They had the blitz on. Little nudge right there.
Look at him run away from the secondary.
And I'll tell you what, those guys are running against gravity or whatever. Looked like they had the angle on him, but he runs out from under the angle.
Breaks the tackle there, and then it's just a foot race. The Black Watcher is the last one.
Well, that guy right there is, I hate to say too much about him. I love him.
He's courageous, let's say it that way.
Well, he's...
He takes pounding every week.
Physical football. He has great play right by Shan Morris right there. That was a little old nothing deal that they called him up right there. I don't like to get into that kind of controversy. Gary Kelly, you're going to see Gary make some big plays here. And look at Edward Phillips and Arthur Johnson. Arthur, it looks like he played much better than he's been playing yesterday with Russ Carrick and Harold Hallman. And
there's the fourth down play.
That is right there. Alex Duchok, Gary Kelly.
Here it is again.
Russ Carrick, Harold Hallman, Arthur Johnson, all there. Plays like that to make you live and die.
That was one of two great fourth down stands.
I mean, you got to have those things. I mean, that's the critical downs in the ball game. That was a critical down right there. It was a third down play where we needed 3 yards for a first down, and Pat Washington runs the option and gets it. And right now, we're just trying to get something going, and Georgia Tech stops us, and we got a punt. And Lewis does a spectacular job of that. And we should have stopped this ball right here. If you can't stop it, they ought not to touch it.
Third and nine here, and he scrambles out and makes the first down.
Well, Dewberry's a good quarterback. Tackled by Pat Thomas. We had a three-man rush on him, and right. Sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. And
this is second and three. They get the first down, and then we'll show all four downs right here.
Edward Phillips again, and
first and
Powell.
Ten.
Edward Phillips again.
Second and six coming.
Porter and 90-something and Edward Phillips.
That was third and two.
Showing up everywhere. Third and two.
They called timeout. Now fourth and one.
Is Russ Carricker coming? And we just kind of just have him surrounded, and he's looking for a place to go and ends up actually slipping down and goodness.
Now it's a matter of running out the clock. And that's the first down.
We got to make some first downs, and great block by the offensive line, and Bo was,
mercy. In the fourth quarter, late in the game, that's his 30th carry right there.
His pat on the bootleg again. Nice game. About 5 or 6 yards.
Third and one here.
Big play on third down, keeping the drive alive. Come with the reverse. Goodness, I would. We just had the ball right there, and then the game was over. We get a 15-yard penalty for holding, or a 10-yard penalty, I guess. And
for clipping. It's third and two, and Bo gets the first down, and that is enough to they haven't had timeouts and run it out.
Well, I'm going to say this, Phil. Georgia Tech has got a fine football team.
They are. They're as good as a top 12 team.
They have got a. The kids played hard. They had a good plan both ways, and they got every right to be proud of their performance yesterday. I know that it's disappointing to come up short, but I'm proud of ours too.
It was a win, big win at Grant Field. We'll be back, going back in the conference next week in just a minute. The conference against Mississippi State next week, Coach. This conference race is brand new all of a sudden.
Well, you know, I said from the beginning that it was the more parity in our conference than ever before. And I said in the beginning, anybody that didn't have to play Florida has got a better chance of winning.
That's right.
So,
last time I checked the schedule, we have to play Florida,
right.
But Mississippi State first.
Right. Well, Mississippi State's already played Florida.
That's right.
But Mississippi State has got a fine football team. They're 4-2, and Don Smith, they're a great quarterback. I haven't looked at them on film. Last year, defensively, they were outstanding.
They're better this year defensively.
Offensively, they are doing more with the offense, and we'll have to be on top of our game to have a chance to win it. I'm sure of that.
The schedule, shall we say we're in the meat of the schedule now?
Well, we're fixing to get down to what comes natural for Auburn in November.
Okay.
Late October and November.
It's a Jordan-Hare kickoff, I think at the regular time for a change this Saturday.
1:30.
And a few tickets remain. I think you can get a ticket if you'll get it early this week. We'll see you next Sunday with replay. Thank you.
You know where we are for is season, the schedule. It's that time of year, man. It's November.
The Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review. Auburn 21, Mississippi State 9. Yesterday at Jordan-Hare Stadium, it may not have been a fans game, Coach, but I bet the old coach liked it anyway.
Well, your competition got a lot to do with what you look like. I was upset after the ball game about not being able to
being more consistent offensively than we are, and I'm still concerned about it. It's been 2 weeks in a row now when the defense, I thought, played well, and offensively we haven't been consistent. And it's yesterday we had 309 yards total offense. The week before, I guess, we had about 400 yards rushing and 17 passing, but been 2 weeks in a row, Phil. And yesterday I thought we got manhandled some, and I thought that, you know what, again, I guess we were good enough to do what we had to do to score the points to win. But I'd like to think that we're going to be more consistent in that going down to these latter part of the season, because we've worked extremely hard to get our defensive football team to the championship caliber defense, and I think we're close if we can stay healthy. And offensively, we seem to have taken a step backwards. We've got to regroup and really look at what we're doing, and you know, it. I think it's coaching. I don't think it's anything else, because when I say coaching, that takes in a wide area of what you're asking the players to do, when you're asking them to do it, and the total thing. Because we got talent, there's no reason we can't have a outstanding offensive football team.
Lewis Colbert had a tremendous performance punter.
Well, he's got to be the best punter in America. I mean, he's the best one that I've ever been around in my life. And he had a great day yesterday, and with that kind of kicking game and with the defense playing the way ours is playing right now, then, you know, we can go back to being very conservative offensively and not turn the football over and hunt and pick and, you know, and run the football and run it and then punt it and play defense and punt it, and then, you know, finally, you know, wait for them to make a mistake, and that's the sure way to win. I'd like to think that we're going to be a little more wide open and have the ability to score more points, but we can go either way.
All right, right now let's go into the locker room, and you'll see the thoughts quickly change to next Saturday.
We've helped the offense out a little, but it was time that we picked up some slack for them. They've been picking up some for us early in the season, and I just hope it continues next week with Florida. That's going to be a big one. We've got to have some good defense against Bell.
Offense has done their job, you know. And defense has had to play a great game, and I think we've done it, you know, so far. It's going to be a big week next week.
That's another step for us. And
it's going to take all barrels next week, isn't it?
Oh, definitely. 11 bullets every play.
Oh, we got to play better on defense for the first thing. They drove the ball on us, but we didn't give up a touchdown. We just probably, we got to, you know, play harder and get more physical, take on the Gators.
You excited about it?
Yes, sure am. I got some uncles down in Florida, and they all hooping and hollering about the Gators this year again.
Well, I tell you, it's going to be the biggest test all year for the defense. I feel if we can just be consistent, you know, at it and keep getting better each week, then we have a chance.
And all the guys, they're coming together. They're working so much harder in practice now, and I feel like we're just getting better and better.
It's going to take everything next week, isn't
it? Yeah, Florida's an excellent team, and I just hope we can go out there and just play hard against them.
You know, everybody's thinking about it right now, and Florida's just, you know, one of the biggest games of the year, and it's turned into one of our biggest rivalries, so we'll be ready.
They kind of embarrassed us last year, and we got something, you know, to prove. You know, they kind of whooped us up front last year, and we think we got a good offensive line, and we want to whoop them this year.
You have to be ready to go out and have a day like today, and I'm kicking. I think I had 9 punts.
I believe it's maybe your best day. What do you think?
I'm very well pleased with it. If I could have just hit that other coffin corner, that one that went in the end zone, I'd have been very happy.
You were getting pressure, outside pressure, both sides. They obviously felt they could get to you.
Evidently, they did. They watched our punt team real close and tried to figure a way to get back there. And every time they were switching over right at the last minute after Tommy Powell made his first call. And so it was catching me off guard, because I was getting in one place and having to move to another to get set up. And, you know, they come close once or twice.
How'd you come through today? How you feel?
I feel great.
You had to get by this one. This is kind of one you just had to have to make next week meaningful, wasn't it?
Yes, it wasn't pretty. It wasn't a pretty sight, but we did what we had to and just outscored them. They were more physical than we were.
You're in a little better shape going into Florida this time than you were last year, aren't you?
Oh, yes. I'm just looking forward to it right now.
If you would like to...
Breezy day at Jordan-Hare and a little cooler. Halloween coming up.
Well, it's a good day for football. There's a little wind in the game. As a matter of fact, they played a part in the game, really. We start out and make a first down here. But I'm going to tell you something. You can watch this film. I thought, really, we had some outstanding plays offensively in the line and different. Here's the first disaster right there. We didn't get backside protection, and the linebacker came free and hit Patty just as he's throwing the ball, and they get a turnover. We come right out playing defense. So there's Tracy Rocker and Russ Carica and Edward Phillips.
Second and eight here.
Pressure on the quarterback. Edward Phillips going to knock him out of bounds. Run him out.
Third and five.
Big play by Andre Bruce and Gerald Robinson. Andre knocks the ball back, bats it down, and they kick the field goal. And that's what's coming away with a real plus there. Of course, you'd like to get a turnover if you could, but just holding to field goal when they get it in that kind of field position is a, you feel like you've done well. We come back offensively, and again, we just, somebody's coming off a block here or there, and pass thrown to Freddie for, we really felt like we could throw the football on them, but our protection didn't stand up, and we didn't execute perfectly, and we had a couple of balls that could have been caught, would have been great catches, but we didn't come up with them, and this wasn't very pretty offensively.
For those Auburn fans who wonder if Auburn's ever going to throw to Bo Jackson, they just did. Didn't complete.
That's it. Well, he gets the ball enough in other ways. This is one of those kind of a fluke play, I guess, kind of like the one we had against Florida State. Luckily, they didn't take it in the end zone. And
I got it.
Make another first down. But we come back. Great play by Tracy Rocker.
Right, and threw a block, too.
Tracy's getting better and better each week. And
second
defensively,
and eight.
You know, our coaching staff defensively had a great game plan to contain Smith. And
third and eight.
I think Smith had 8 yards rushing yesterday, and you see him, we closing in on him, we get him contained, turn him back up inside, and people close on him. There's Harold Hallman, Tracy Rocker again, Gerald Robinson makes time. Gerald Robinson, I don't know how he graded yet, but he made a lot of plays, and I think he sacked the quarterback at least twice.
So they take a 6-0 lead in the first quarter.
Lawyer Tillman catching the ball there, and Lawyer had two plays that you'll see this would have been great catches, but he has that ability to make those great catches. Bo is running hard and breaking tackles, and not a lot of running room in that time just today, and what he got was
hard-earned.
Hard-earned is right. It was a kind of sweep, and those guys just look like they're talking about some of our basketball players. I understand they had a scrimmage yesterday. Did you see any of it, Till?
Second quarter going the other way. Now, they will have scrimmages the second and the ninth, next week and the following Saturday before the game.
As Lewis punting again, and that guy feels it on the 5-yard line, and our coverage is down there, and we get him on the five. Alex Sperlin and Ed Sperlin and Jonathan Robinson and Pat Moat. And
middle of the quarter now. They're going the other way.
Again, we got him contained. Tracy Rocker again. He is hard to hem up.
That's about the only success they had throwing.
Tommy
ball
Powell hit some licks in the ball game yesterday that were all-timers still. He just, he slips up and goes down to the ground. And it's a nice play by Tommy right there, and Tracy Rocker and Arthur Johnson, and you can see a lot of blue jerseys showing up around the football, and that's the way it's supposed to be played. They missed a field goal here.
Still 6-0.
We're still trying to get something started offensively, and I guess it's fixing to start right now, isn't it?
Second and three, right.
We run the play. Bo makes a great run right there. That guy's got a solid tackle on him. He pulls away and gains another 6 yards with just pure effort.
Second down and eight at the Auburn 47 now.
Pat makes a nice throw and catch right here with Trey Gaines.
Now it's at the 35, and here comes
Brent Fullwood makes a great run, breaking tackles, and, you know, this is what I expected us to do all day long, but it wasn't like that.
Short yardage for the first down.
AG makes a nice run inside, and then Bo's going to take it to distance right here.
Look at this cut.
Good block right there by
Mike Bolton.
Scott Bolton.
Scott Bolton.
Scott Bolton. Steve Wallace.
Watch this cut. Oh.
Jeff Parks. You know, the great thing about Bo is that, you know, he's got that ability to make those pretty runs and like that right there, but that tough yardage he gets inside. There's a great hit right there by Edward Phillips, caused a fumble we didn't come up with. We had a couple of balls on the ground yesterday, two or three, I guess, if we didn't come up with any of them, but we get to causing them, we'll come up with some of them. This is Lundy in at quarterback. Smith got hurt a little bit, and Joe Robinson runs him out of bounds on the 3.5-yard line.
And with just 30 seconds to go after they punt, it's a big play.
It was a big play, and we get the ball at the 29-yard line with, what, 31 seconds to go?
31 seconds to go.
And we noticed that the safeties had been playing us a particular way, and Coach Crow and Coach Blakeney got together and felt like we could beat them down the middle for the touchdown, and Freddie beat them, and Pat hit them with a football, and it was a well-executed play, and we're just not getting enough of those kind. But it put us ahead 14-6, and, you know, I felt good about the ball game all the way, Phil, because our defense was playing so well. But I just, we couldn't put them away, and that's what you've got to be able to do.
Okay, and we will be back in just a minute.
Over 60 and sporting events. All right, our Auburn University feature today deals with a new program from the Cooperative Extension Service at Auburn.
Agriculture and forestry in Alabama have undergone...
Folks will pick this up from around the country.
Maybe so. Maybe so. And get old Will headed toward a liver transplant. Now let's get back into the second half of play. And Auburn has not really established itself yet, Coach.
Well, you know, we had to go into halftime with a lot of momentum. And you can see we come back out playing good defense. And we stopped them two or three times, Phil. And
third and seven here.
That's...
Now we move down to their next series.
They drop a pass. And
there goes Andre Bruce again up in the...
Well, we got after Smith all day long, and our defense is having fun playing, and the offense, it seems like we just nothing consistent. We'll have a big play here, there, and here's a big one coming up right here. And it sets up a touchdown, and Bo makes a big run, and Brent comes in and makes a big play, and he breaks a tackle right there and outruns a few of them and cuts back and makes one miss in here. And that big linebacker is a good football player for Mick Pearson. He made a lot of plays, and he tackled Bo about, 40, 50 yards downfield.
Right.
Tommy A.G. makes a big run inside, and
Bo had 169 yards on 28 carries yesterday.
Well, it was hard-earned yards, most of it. There's Brent making a nice cut and move, picking up the first down for us after Tommy's run. Pat Washington's going to make a nice run on the option here and get it down to the 4-yard line.
And run through a tackler.
Right, and Pat's a big, strong youngster, and Bo takes it in. Great block right here by Jeff Hawks and Ron Middleton, and I'm sure Stacy Searles and whoever was at right guard there. That's
got a pat from Dr. Houston in the end zone.
Yen Cowart. Dr. Houston was over yesterday, and I tell you, Phil, speaking about Dr. Houston, we are blessed to have that kind of facility for our athletes. I mean, we had trouble with the kickoff right here. But our athletes, it is a comforting thing to know that you got the best in the world
50 miles 30, down the road.
30 minutes from you, and they come into our dressing room, they come into our training room 3 or 4 times a week. Nice play right there by Edward Phillips and Tracy Rocker, and big play by Pat Thomas, and both our weak tight ends look like they're playing good right now. That's Chuck and his lady friend. And
pretty fair basketball player there.
Yeah. Both, you can break a tackle there, miss a tackle there, and three of them hit him.
Get piled on.
That is almost a great catch right there by Lawyer Tillman. And like I said, Lawyer had a great week of practice last week. And
this is a punt.
It's getting better. And of course, all our receivers, I don't see anything particularly wrong with could have just 70 yards. It's hard to cover a 70-yard punt field. I mean, it's, you know, it's has a big hit and a fumble caused by Benji Rowland. There's another guy that's getting better every week. It's a good run. A couple of missed tackles right there at the line of scrimmage and picks up 10 or 12 yards. Great play by Russ Carrickton and had good pressure on the quarterback, good coverage. Jimmy Warren comes in and helps out. Here's a pressure. You can see him running. We got him trapped. The line did a great job of containing him and keeping him hemmed up because that guy, believe me, can go. I don't know. He had rushed for 675 yards coming into our ball game, Phil, and he only had 8 yards rushing yesterday.
Right. He averaged about 275.
Outstanding kickoff return right here by Brent Poolwood. I saw Alex Berlin make an outstanding block, and we'll get the ball out back out to the 28-yard line. And again, typical Mississippi State. You know, they play Auburn like they got a grudge against us or something. Of course, I want to tell you something. Our folks hit them too. Mm-hmm. As Pearson making a sack on the quarterback and
almost blocked. They felt like they could block.
Well, I'm sure that they brought that pressure to try to cut out on his efficiency. Mm-hmm.
Yet he averaged 46 yards in punt. His average.
They don't get much running room inside. And here's looking back for that tight end. That tight end is Gerald Robinson, second and quarterback again.
There was coverage in the secondary.
Along with Pat Thomas and Harold Holman over there. And again, Gerald Robinson, I know, tackled him 4 or 5 times. Ball pitched to Bo, and Bo very near came out of there with that one. And run the draw, and we missed one of their two techniques. And linebacker, no gain on the draw.
This is against a stiff wind here.
Well, they should have got it. That should have been a 15-yard penalty there. Mm-hmm. They said the reason they didn't penalize the 15 yards is because they ran into each other before they hit. So that don't make any difference. It's what the damage they do to our guy.
That's why the rule is there, isn't it? To protect the punter.
Again, we got him contained here. Gerald Williams is in his face. And Gary Kelly picks it off, returns it down to 33-yard line. I had hoped that we would get in a situation, a position to play a lot of folks yesterday, Phil, and Jeff Berger comes in the game and runs a naked
almost
reverse.
Almost scores.
Yeah.
And then Auburn runs the clock out, not trying to score, really. Right.
You know, I don't want to get into the posture of swapping the quarterbacks around, and I'm still just as confident as I can be in Jeff Berger and Bobby Walden as I was early in the year. But I don't think that that's the right thing to do for our football team right now, moving, running quarterbacks in and out of the football game. But if we could get a comfortable enough lead in some games, I sure would like to see them play. But we had a lot of kids I would have liked to have gotten in the football game. We're playing a lot of people anyway. But I'd like to play Brent Fullwood more and Kyle Collins and Curtis Stewart and Demetrius Threat and some of our offensive linemen that didn't get a lot of playing time. I'd like to play our tight ends, two young tight ends, Walter Reeves and Lee Mark Sellers.
They're going to be fine ones.
Yeah. And some folks on defense. We need to be developing some depth in the secondary at the corner position particularly. But we just, the ball games that we've been in have been such that we haven't been able to, the Florida State game, you'd think we could have played some there, but it was 28 points in the last 4 minutes. So we didn't have time to play any there. And really the Ole Miss game is the only chance we've had to play them.
We'll be back in just a minute.
Another flower cap.
Said if it is November, and if it is a November to remember, it will begin next week with Florida. Sorry, no tickets, no TV. We'll have it for you, though, here next week at this time. See you then.
Oh. on the plains all season long. This is Bob Neal. Put your orange and blue where it counts with spirited Auburn souvenirs from Anders Bookstore.
I think the first thing we got to do is give Florida credit, because they did what they had to do to win the football game. I think that's got to come first. And I think the second thing that we better do is just kind of evaluate where we are and understand and realize that it's a bitter, bitter defeat. And one that we had a lot of people that laid their guts on the line. Some laid everything they had out there, and it wasn't good enough. I think Florida's a great football team. I think they're a great football team. So you're just a little bit shy of being a great football team yourself. And if we had just a little more, and Mike can get it by the time we play Alabama, we might can get it by the time we play East Carolina, Mike can get it by the time we play Georgia. We can become a great football team this year. We can become a great football team this year. But we're not there yet. We're not far away. You young men, strong bodies, strong minds. There's going to be battles every day that are fought and won and lost. Some of them are going to be more important than others. This is one of them today. You're not going to win them all. But Lord help you if you don't throw your hat in the ring and fight them. Because if you ain't got enough courage and you ain't got enough stuff to you to want to get in these kind of games, then you won't ever amount to much, man. There are a lot of the folks around this country would have liked to have been out there today playing in your place that ain't good enough to be there.
Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you by Colonial Bank, the bank in your future. Long's Electronics, tomorrow's electronics today. Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Alabama Farm Bureau Insurance. With Farm Bureau, you know you've got the best. And by Snapper, manufacturer of quality power lawn equipment.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review. A great football game at Jordan-Hare Stadium yesterday. Auburn lost to Florida 14-10. Coach, it was just a classic. We were on the wrong side, I guess.
Well, Phil, I think you look at the game, and it was a great football game. The Florida team is I think, probably the best football team we've played since we've been at Auburn. And,
you know, we had a great game plan. You know, a game like this, you feel like you gave your all, and, you know, you come up short. You know, it's the kind of game that really hurts. But, you know, I think we got a strong team, and God's speeding wheel behind us. I think that, you know, a little adversity will set us back. Now, you know, we should all pull together now.
Now we have to regroup and realize that our season's not over yet, even though we did lose a heartbreaker today. And we have to come back next week. It'll be the last time we'll ever, all the seniors that have played at Jordan-Hare, and go on from there. Just play as hard as we can each week and see what happens.
We can't give up now. We worked too hard. We worked hard for 4 years since we've been here. We just got to try to finish up strong.
They made enough big plays. They made two of them that really hurt us, and then it's hard to overcome that.
It's exciting to play a game like this.
Yeah, it's exciting for our kids. I know they feel terrible right now, but they'll bounce back on it.
That was the most crowded press box I've ever seen at Auburn. Bold people, just people from major newspapers and news services.
I've never seen tickets that hard to come by. We didn't. It was not available. I guess we could have sold probably 15,000 more tickets if we'd have had them. They won the toss and elected to kick off. A great play right there by Shan Morris and Pat Thomas and John Dobbs. Our defense played as well as we could play yesterday, except for two plays. Phil, we got great pressure on the quarterback. Fine play right there by Tracy Rocker and Pat Thomas. Pressure right here by Gerald Williams and sidesteps him, and Gerald comes back and runs him down. Bell is an outstanding quarterback. We gave him a lot of problems yesterday, but he hurt us on a couple of plays. And outstanding play right there by Kevin Porter, Tommy Powell, and
so they have to punt it away, and this is all
first play. We run the trap, and Tommy Agee makes about 89 yards. We make a first down, come back, and Freddie runs a reverse for, I think, 12 or 14 yards. We take this one down and get a field goal. Bo makes about 6 or 7 inside, and we have an offsides penalty right here that really hurt us in the crucial situation. We change up a snap count, and that's a... Chris Johnson kicks field goal. Chris, I guess, what was it, 46-yarder?
Yes, his second of the year.
Well, he's out. Our long yardage kicker. Tracy Rocker sacks Bell for, what, a 15-yard loss or something?
17-yard.
Threw to a tight end some yesterday and had success with it. Had hits Jeff Parks on about a 10 or 11-yard pass to make a first down. Bo comes back and runs the counter sweep for...
12-yard gain. Third and four play coming right here now. Big out.
Nice plays to Freddie.
Here comes the fumble.
Right there with the... They get the ball at the 22-yard line. That's the only turnover in the game, and a very costly one to us. If we could have taken that one in, we'd have had a 10-point lead. We come back and playing well on defense. Andre Bruce and Gerald Williams, Edward Phillips. Jimmy Warren makes a great play here and a near interception.
Third and 11 coming now.
Pressure again, you can see Bell, and the ball like to stay hung up that long enough for Edward Phillips to get it, but pressure and...
Auburn with field position in the late in the quarter now.
It felt like we could have a chance to beat them off of a sweep fake here. That's a big first.
Short of the first on third and three there now. Here comes a play to try to draw them off.
Well, that's a... We shift to short punt formation, and then we end up killing the clock and taking a 5-yard penalty.
Punting.
Fine play by Harold Hallman and Pat Thomas and Tracy Rocker. It's a defensive front, played extremely well. And
second quarter
time
now.
And time again, Harold Hallman again.
Third and two, that play. And stopping
Gerald again. Williams and Tracy Rocker and... Just, they missed a field goal here. We up 3-0, and our defense is playing extremely well, and they get a pass interference call, and we get the ball out around midfield.
Third and 7.
We don't convert and have to punt. The punting game was big yesterday, and thought Lewis did a great job. He didn't have one of his better days distance-wise, but he kicked the ball and kicked it, stopped it at the 1. Got one's about the 12.
41.7-yard average.
Two great running backs for Florida, John L. Williams and Neil Anderson.
This is their touchdown drive now.
They are doing a good job now mixing up the pass and the run.
Florida's got great speed at the wide receivers and skill positions. They're just unbelievable. There's a big hit right here by Pat Thomas. Bell dumped it off to Neil Anderson. And
third and six right here.
That was a big, big play in the ball game, and we actually had a missed assignment on it. I think we might have had him sacked. If you got a blitz on, you can't let him stand back there that long.
They punch it twice and then throw into the end zone for the touchdown.
It was a great drive by Florida right there, and we come back and get the ball back out to around midfield. And
Bo Jackson is injured by now.
Right, Bo has bruised his thigh, and we got a chance to get it back in field goal range and come up a little short. Threw a little screen pass that Thomas made some big plays on, and they stopped us right before the half. And I guess this is the last play of the half where right. We get the pressure again by Gerald Williams and Tracy Rocker and sack the quarterback again. So at half is Florida 7 and Auburn 3, and I feel good about our chances of winning the football game because I felt like we were playing well enough on defense, and I just couldn't see them containing us and stopping us all day on offense. I knew that we would.
This is a big birthday year for the Auburn School of Pharmacy, and that is the subject of Carl Velker's report.
In Auburn, Alabama in 1865, the Board of Trustees at Alabama Polytechnic Institute decided that the school should begin offering pharmacy courses. Since then, the Auburn University School of Pharmacy has grown into a fully developed five-year curriculum, including an optional Doctor of Pharmacy program. During the past 100 years, pharmaceutical education at Auburn University has grown from a relatively informal collection of courses to the current five-year program. In 1895, pharmacy became a regular course of instruction. To be admitted to study pharmacy, students were required to be at least 15 years old and of good moral character. Beginning in 1959, 9 quarters of professional school study were required for graduation. The 5 years required for the degree in pharmacy are still divided into 2 years of pre-pharmacy and 3 years of professional study. Today, more than ever before, the pharmacist is an integral part of healthcare, and the Auburn University School of Pharmacy is proud of 100 years of service to the people of Alabama and the South.
You had planned to use some one-back offense in the second half and do some things differently, but I guess that went out the window with Bo?
Well, it did, and we did run one play of it, and we came up short on first down, third down play, where we threw the ball to Ron Middleton. But we had primarily used it to, wanted to get in it to try to balance them up front and run the ball, getting it to bowl. But the one thing that I think, looking back at the film, that, you
that's
know,
a third down play.
Right, if we could have had more success throwing the ball, but not only that, but we should have run straight at them more than trying to run the sweep so much. We could have run the isolation or trap or sprint draw, which we had success on.
Another third down play there that came up short. Auburn has to punt. Actually, they were good on third down. It's only 2 of 10 times. Auburn 6 of 18, but a lot of third down plays when you play a good defense.
Well, we almost had a big play right there, and that's Andre Booth made a great play, and then one of the other players carried it in the end zone. Fine play on Neil Anderson.
Third and 9 for them on this play. Gonna hold him just short of the first.
It's John L. Williams running the ball and knocked out of bounds by Tommy Powell and Arthur Johnson.
Their man punted well.
He's got I think he averaged 47 yards. He did a great job. That guy right there did a great job yesterday, too.
He
returned,
did.
I think, 7 punts for 75 yards. He averaged a first down every time they punted the football.
He took some punishment, too, returning those.
Pat hitting Jeff Parks for a key first down.
Gets hit at these throws there.
We don't like much being a showing up good football team field, but we just
Pat Moat the Auburn snapper.
That's a big, big play in the ball game. Right there, normally you get a score when that happens right there. If you can get somebody backed up and make them punt the ball from off the goal line, you're going to get the ball in field position, and normally you get a field goal or a touchdown out of it, and that's exactly what happened yesterday. That's what you call field position football, and we knew they'd try to go deep once. Mm-hmm. And they come out and give it to Anderson. And outstanding play by Harold Hallman and Pat Thomas, and they had to punt the ball out of the end zone, and we get it back in excellent field position.
At the Florida 42.
Run the isolation, and Brent makes a nice run inside. This is just a kind of a methodical drive right here where we run a little and throw once, and Jeff Parks again makes a nice catch at the 20-yard line. Come back and run the option. Pat makes a key first down right there. Gets the ball down to the 10-yard line.
This is the first down here on third and one. And that is the last play of the third quarter. Going to the fourth quarter now. Same drive as they switch into the field.
The ball's at the 8-yard line. We run the isolation, and Brent gets it down to the 3. One time AG, one time inside for 1, and Pat Washington takes it over for the touchdown from the 2-yard line. And we go out front here 7-3, and the momentum in the game has changed, and I feel good about our chances of winning the football game here. Tracy Rocker, again, you can see our defense is playing extremely well. It would get pressure, sack the quarterback, Gerald Robinson, and Gary Kelly.
3rd and 16 now. He's going to throw another, this one away.
Another big one here where we get pressure on him, and he grounds the football. They lose a down plus 5 yards from that spot, and we get the ball back in great field position. But the problem is that we don't make a first down, and we don't move the football, and we give it back to him here. We run a reverse to try to get the big play and come up short. Here we get called for grounding. And
give them field position.
Right, and then I guess Lewis hits about a 40-yarder here or whatever, but it's not one of his better punts, and they get the ball at the 39-yard line. And this is where they take it in to go ahead right here. Bell makes a key play right here on third down. He scrambles out. We have a little pressure on him, but that play right there was a 17, 18-yard play that gave him, put him the ball at the 40-yard line.
And here comes
the
big
draw play right here from the 40. It was a second down situation, and it was a missed tackle and another missed tackle, and but that guy right there is a great back, and he'll make you miss some tackles.
Right.
We stop him a couple of times, and then they come back and throw the fade route to a wide receiver, great throw and catch.
McDonald.
It's a play like that is virtually impossible to defend against if you execute it, and they executed it to perfection. They kick off to us. It's 10-7.
Jan Morris comes out with it.
Well, I guess it's, what, 13-10 at this time? 14-10.
14-10.
And that's the one play Bo came back in and tried to play, but again, he couldn't play. And I guess that was the last play. He just trotted on off the field because he knew he couldn't run. And
this is a third down play.
That gave us the ball. It's actually 4th and 2 now. And should make that one, but we don't. And it's a gives them the ball back, and they run 3 plays and punt. We come back and make 1 first down, and the game's over with. We didn't execute very well right here at the late stages of the game. I know a lot of people are wondering why we ran the football there. We actually were wanted to pass it, but we comboed the pass with a run, and where you can, if according to the alignment they line up in, you may run it or throw it, and if the run is there, you got a chance to get a big play off the run. And
that's because they were double covering the
had double covering, and we hand the ball off. We don't make a first down. We don't get to stop. The clock stopped, and it's history.
It was two great football teams.
It wasn't exactly what we'd planned to do, and it didn't look very good to me, and I'm sure that I'll get some I'll hear about it.
Well, but you wouldn't have heard if he had broken a 20 or 25-yard run up the middle, Coach.
You know, a game like that that's that close and that hard fought and you know, the teams are that equal, you can look back in this a half a dozen plays or less. The two plays on the pass play that put the ball at the 10 and the draw play that put the ball at the 6, those two plays on defense. I think an offsides penalty when we had the ball in and had to settle for the field goal.
A lot of momentum.
And the fumble going in. And outside of that, you know, they gained 240 yards offense. We had 236, and they scored 14 points, and we scored 10. And game was, you know, it was a classic college football game that just, you know, we lost. And Florida beat us. And we have no excuses that my hat's off to them. They're a great football team, and their coaching staff and their players have done a great job. When something like this happens, they got the best head coach, they got the best players, they got the best assistant coaches, and they could very well be the best football team in America.
Let's come back and talk about next week in just a minute. For next week, a few tickets and still an opportunity to go on and win the last three and be on a New Year's Day bowl, Coach.
Well, I think if we won the next two, I think we'd have a good chance of getting a good bowl. And certainly our goal is to win the next three. It's not going to be easy, and it's not going to get any easier. Big thing right now is to put this one behind us and everybody pull together and get up and get ready to play East Carolina at homecoming and improve and get to be a better football team this coming week. And because we got to be a better football team when we play Georgia.
And we'll be back next Sunday with the replay of Auburn, East Carolina. Join us then.
Next week is a big week. Get started today. Making your plans ready for Georgia. You know what happened in Jacksonville today. And, I mean, we knew men early in the year. Every year it's coming down to November. And what happens in November is going to determine what happens in January. And no doubt that, I mean, you played Florida last week and you saw what Georgia did today. So they've got to have an outstanding football team. I think that the stage will be set for you over there next Saturday. So let's just be sure that we're ready for the challenge when we get there.
The Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you by Colonial Bank, the bank in your future. Long's Electronics, tomorrow's electronics today. Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Alabama Farm Bureau Insurance. With Farm Bureau, you know you've got the best. And by Snapper, manufacturer of quality power lawn equipment.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review. 73rd homecoming at Auburn yesterday, and a 35-10 victory over East Carolina. A place kind of close to home for you, Coach.
Well, the way I saw a lot of old friends yesterday and Friday, coming in for the game, and it was a game I really didn't care about beating East Carolina because it meant too much to me and my family. Greenville and the eastern part of the state up there, it was still like a second home. Players, and it was a fun day. Phil, we didn't.
First
we
half,
can't,
I thought well, the players we were kind of
flat. Well, we were kind of flat, and you know, defensively, the way they didn't score any points, but we wasn't getting a lot of people around the ball. And offensively, we had several opportunities to get the ball in the end zone, and it was just not a lot of emotions out there. And But we ended up the second half played a lot of people, and you know, a lot of folks that have worked awful hard through the year and hadn't had the opportunity to play as much as we'd like for them to play. They all got the chances out there yesterday and got to play all three quarterbacks, and you know, some people got an opportunity to participate that they hadn't been. I thought it ended up good, and
it was obvious that Bo Jackson was not at full speed, didn't play the second half.
Well, I knew going into the game, and if it had been really left up to me, I wouldn't have played him in the ball game. But I left it up to him, and he wanted to try to go, and he played the first half. And I could see from the first time he touched the football that he wasn't 100%. Then I thought he might loosen up and we could go ahead and go, but it didn't, and we took him out. But I really think he'll be fine this week unless, you know, something happened yesterday. But you know, as great as Bo is, there's not a lot of drop-off at tailback.
No, number 22 seemed to have a pretty good day, as you'll see. Now, in the post-game dressing room, of course, the news had already arrived that Georgia had defeated Florida, and that was mostly the topic of conversation.
Oh, that we got to go up in Athens and be ready to play ball, because they're going to come out ready to play.
You're going to have a shiner this week, aren't you?
Just a little one.
How about Georgia today, beating Florida like that?
You know, I was kind of surprised myself, but, you know.
What does that make next week?
We got to buckle down and go after them.
I'm glad they beat them. Because it hurt, you know, losing to them last week, and I'm glad they beat them. And so with us going in there with a win, they're coming off a big win. It's going to be a good game.
Got to give you another chance, man.
Yeah.
We got a lot of guys going home. It's a lot of fun to go to Georgia Tech and play, but I think this is the real place that we like to go play.
I really couldn't believe that. I figured Florida had the best team in the nation, but Georgia, you know, did what they had to do.
What does that do for Auburn?
We got to have a great week of practice this week.
Well, I love to go back over there. You know, I know a bunch of people from Georgia, and all, you know, me being from Georgia, I love to go over there and hopefully beat them in our own place.
Georgia's capable of playing big games, and they're a big, big team that can play a big game. And I think we need to be ready, because I'm going back home to play Georgia and all my teammates and my friends from the All-Star game, so I'm excited.
I don't know how they did it, but they did it. But we got to go in there with our heads up, ready to play like we played last week. And I know Georgia's not going to lay down. We're going to have to lay our ears back and go at them.
Yeah, that's us pretty. We got it back where we want it, you know. And I think if we beat...
I have a coach.
Down by the seniors to the stadium. This was their last home game, and it's kind of a special group for you.
Well, this crowd, I guess, after yesterday, has won more games in a four-year period of time than any senior class in Auburn history. And
36 to date.
And they are outstanding bunch of young men, and been a lot of fun to coach them and watch them grow and mature as men. And you got to feel good about that future when they leave Auburn.
They'll make good alums, huh?
Absolutely. Good husbands, good daddies. We knew East Carolina was a capable football team coming into the game, and Phil, we had planned to throw the football, and I didn't want to go out and try to run up a score throwing the football, but I wanted to throw the football, or we wanted to throw the football 25 or 30 times. I think we ended up throwing it 25 times, but I just know that we're capable of throwing it and executing the passing game. It's just a matter of us going out and doing it and having success with it. We come out and we are throwing and having some success. And Pat hits Freddie a couple of times and then comes back for Scott Bolton. And East Carolina.
That's not the Bo we know there.
No, he's not, doesn't have that great quickness that he, you know, normally has. And but he still ran the ball pretty well yesterday. That was a fine play by, I don't know if it was Nate Hill or Gerald Williams, but we had trouble in the first half feeling the punch. Freddie's sun's in his eyes, and the guy was kind of erratic kicking the football, and we didn't get a couple of them feeling, and really gave us bad field position. Had a long way to go. Bo makes a great run here coming off the goal line and picks up a first down, and we get a penalty right here and puts us back, and he makes another great run right here. That this run right here, you really wouldn't know he even had speed.
That's right.
But we come up about a foot short on the first down and have to punt to him. They come back on offense, and
That big old quarterback they got is that started against us, they played two, but this guy right here has got great speed and quickness and is a great athlete and weighs about 215 pounds.
Mm-hmm. You'll see that in a minute when he carries Nate Hill for a while, I believe, on this play.
There's Nate Hill.
Bulldogging.
We, you know, I was with the coaches about it, but we really didn't swarm the football on defense last year. I mean, yesterday like we have in the past few weeks. I guess after last week's game and homecoming distractions and everything that you could expect some letdown. This is Brent coming back. It makes a nice run on the sprint draw, and Brent does have a great day running the football. Our offensive line's coming off of football, doing a good job, and we're executing the passing game. And right there, Lawyer Tillman had an excellent day yesterday. Ball, a great week of practice.
He's 6'5". That young guy is catching a lot of balls, too.
Scott played real well yesterday. We didn't play Trey Gaines, and Freddie got hurt, so Scott and Lawyer got most of the action.
And the freshness of Brent Fullwood. Had 153 yards yesterday.
Well, Brent picks up key first down, and Pat comes back and gets it down close. I'm not sure that's first down right there, but anyway, we take this one in. Brent takes it in on the sweep right here from about 5 yards out, and we go up 7-0.
In the second quarter now. Here's the replay of that one. A lot of good blocks up inside. And so Auburn's on the board.
Brent's been, you know, he's been kind of bunged up a little bit. His knees have bothered him since the Tennessee game, and that's good pursuit and getting some folks around the football there and pressure on the quarterback. And
they have to punt again. Now we're looking at their next series.
I thought we had a good crowd yesterday, Phil.
Excellent.
Just good homecoming crowd and folks out in the parking lots cooking and barbecuing and tailgating and picnicking and chilling, running everywhere. And
that was a 5-yard penalty, not enough to give them the first down.
Is Alex Sperling. Alex did an excellent job yesterday.
Fielding
and running them back. And Alex is not the fastest guy in the world, but the reason he's back there is because he's got excellent hands and did a great job in the spring of turning plus. Hits Jeff Park there and throwing to the tight ends more and getting production out of it. Pat pitches the ball to Brent on the option, and he hits a little seam and runs 16, 18 yards. And
he takes a blow, and here comes Curtis Stewart.
Well, that Curtis is, you know, everybody likes to watch him play because he's he's a north and south runner. No dodging.
No dodging.
We have nobody open, and Pat gets pressure and gets sacked, and this is the worst thing of the day. And that field goal blocked, and can miss one or later.
Was that just a good rush or timing or what, Coach?
Timing. We were slow on it. We got it off, and I forgot exactly what it was, but the coach on the sideline timed it, and we told him he was slow an extra point. We told him he was slow, and we still didn't get the thing down to where we should have.
Almost a block here is Auburn going for it just before the half.
Alex Furley makes another excellent return here.
It does. And so a last ditch drive in the second quarter now.
If they get down, and I guess miss a field goal, don't we?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Pat hits a couple of receivers.
Real Latin.
Scott Bolton and was that thing wide to the left?
To the right, I thought.
Well, I couldn't tell either, but it wasn't any good anyway, so.
So a sluggish first half, huh, Coach?
Right, it wasn't exactly like I would have liked for it to be.
We'll be back in just a minute.
The presentation of the home court was the feature of halftime yesterday at Auburn, and let's see these beautiful young ladies. That's Jenny Jackson, a sophomore in pre-business. Laura Nigro, a senior in finance at Auburn. Of course, their fathers are escorting them. Stephanie Staff, a junior in psychology. And Ann Tucker, a senior in marketing. And this year's homecoming queen is Melanie Sively of Birmingham, a junior in nursing. Crowned halftime ceremonies. Governor Wallace was there to do the honors.
I'm not sure, Coach.
I think so.
They are chosen by vote of the Auburn student body. And then, of course, the great Auburn band was in evidence again. That far side will look different in a couple of years, won't it, Coach?
Well, I hope so.
What a great day it was. Beautiful weather and a big homecoming crowd.
It was a good day. And
green grass in November. It's nice.
Absolutely. Paul Connors did his usual great job in having the field in excellent condition. And
were you fussing in the dressing room at this time, Coach?
Well, I couldn't feel real good about what we'd done because I could see that we weren't gang tackling, getting the swarm in the football, and I knew that we'd missed several opportunities to take a ball and drive it and sustain it, and the players knew it. I mean, it wasn't anything that, as Boss Hogg and some of the trainers there on the sideline, Tracy Rocker, Tracy made a lot of tackles yesterday, and he is really playing great football.
Come on.
Pat Thomas on big play. Gerald Robinson, Harold Hallman, and Gerald Williams.
Really set up things in the second half. Auburn in good field position after they were back there.
This is Brent on the first play of the second half. Runs a sprint draw. Defense got the ball in excellent field position and what, 45-yard run for the touchdown.
Broke a tackle or two here, I'm telling you. What a great cut.
Something. Just.
They call him Nuclear Sub now.
Well, he had a good week of practice last week and just. East Carolina comes back, and East Carolina runs basically the same offense that Florida State ran last year. Do a good job on the reverse here. Pat Thomas plays it perfect, and Pat and Gerald Williams and Harold Hallman all combined to make a tackle, and Bo is retired now and cheerleading. And that little old tailback for East Carolina is a good football player, too.
Baker, he's good.
I think he's probably going to set the all-time East Carolina rushing record. They've had some pretty good backs up there. This is Darrell Speed, and you can see that big guy can run with a football now. I mean, he must be 4'5 or 4'6 and weighs 215 pounds. And do a good job right here on the goal line stand. Edward Phillips and Arthur Johnson, yard loss. Good coverage on the fade right here by Kevin Porter. Try one more trap option here stop them at the 2, and they kick a field goal. Make it 14-3.
Auburn's next series.
East Carolina, I thought, played hard throughout the football game, and I have no doubt that Art Baker will build a program there that they can certainly be proud of. Again, running a sprint draw, and Brent breaks it outside and makes a nice game.
They played Miami and Penn State tough games, close games.
Well, they were actually ahead of Miami in the third quarter, 15-14, I think, and finally lost 27-15. That's another great throw and catch by Lawyer Tillman. And
hard to throw it over him, isn't it, Coach? 6'5".
Well, he's just a big target and has a fine play, critical down right there, throwing back to Ron Middleton. And Brent makes a nice run here. That was a fourth down play right there, field where we fourth and a couple and run the sweep, and Brent picks it up. And here we come on a big play on, I believe it's third and long, and run the sweep again for the touchdown. And
three touchdowns for number 22 yesterday.
Good blocking. He's got the speed and ability to get out there and make it happen, and that's what he does. So that's 21-3. And
here comes another quickly. Watch this one. Their first play after the kickoff.
Tommy Powell makes a great interception and a great run with it when he catches it. Picks up some blocking, great block right there by Shan Morris. Gets back across the grain, and Andre Bruce kind of screens him running in the end zone. And boy, I tell you what,
careful, Andre.
Tommy's teammates love him, I can tell you that, because he is a 100% pure football player.
He was a running back at Greenville, so he used some of that ability.
He's a contact player. He's a smart player. He's everything you could want in a free safety. And in my opinion, there's no one in this conference close to him at the free safety position. And I'm sure he's going to make all conference.
He put together a long drive.
Might make all American.
He should.
I haven't seen one better.
That's Baker.
Tony Baker again. And again, East Carolina's playing hard and played hard throughout the football game. It's Curtis Stewart again, and with the score 28-10, we playing everybody. There's Brent Gilbert and
good throw
Stacy Dunn. There's Jeff Berger throwing to Lawyer Tillman, completing a nice pass. Vincent Jones and Lee Mark Sellers and Walter Reeves playing. Duke Donaldson has a nice play by Edward Phillips. And
they going on it 4-2 here.
Alex Duchok and Tracy Rocker and Edward Phillips. And that's a big play on fourth down. Stop them. Again there. Nice play by Kevin Porter. Catches it out of bounds. Good pressure right here by Gerald Robinson. And that little quarterback scrambles out and lays it up. And Ray Corn intercepts. Gives the ball on the 31-yard line. And
Mike Kelly is going to intercept one here in a few minutes that we didn't get on.
Bobby Waldron at quarterback now. And Bobby gets hit pretty good right there on the sideline. But gets up and takes him in for the score. Kyle Collins. Kyle played, he and Curtis were alternating at tailback and fullback yesterday. I think they were arguing over who was going to get the ball. One of them played fullback one play and one the next. Here Kyle gets the last call and runs it in for the touchdown. And
I always remember Kyle in that Tennessee game.
Coach. Well, he is a fine football player, but he's a better person. And that's a great leader for us. And 35-10, I should say, and I hope everybody left happy.
I think they did, and we'll be back to talk about next week in just a minute. We'll talk about two things, the conference and then Georgia. That tie of Alabama and LSU didn't help anything. There are three teams with 3-1-1 records, Tennessee with 2-1-1 record, two wins and one loss. It kind of puts Tennessee in a good position, doesn't it?
Well, I'd say that Tennessee is in the driver's seat right now because they've got all they've got to do is win the games. I think that we, Georgia and Alabama and LSU, have got to hope somebody beat somebody else for us to be in the picture. And of course, we in the bottom of that list because we got two losses. And but we've got to play Georgia this. You know, they're still in it, and Alabama's still in it. And, of course, LSU's got to play Mississippi State. It always gives them a problem, so.
A lot can happen in the last couple of weeks.
The Sugar Bowl is down there scratching their head, I guess. But somebody will go, and it'll be a good game. I'm more concerned about Georgia right now than I am about us going to the Sugar Bowl.
That surprised you in Jacksonville yesterday?
Not really. Georgia is an outstanding football team. They've been getting better all year long. The two freshman running backs, matured a great deal. Defensively, they've always been outstanding. And I knew that Florida would not be the same football played here last Saturday, so Georgia more or less had an easy open day to, game against Tulane where they probably rested their people and probably worked on Florida. But it makes a lot of difference, Phil, when you can take a week off as far as just a mental preparation and get ready to play a big game like that. And Florida's always at a disadvantage when they play Georgia because of playing Auburn the week before, and it's a game that the Georgia-Auburn game is one that is always a hard-fought game, and it's a game where the home team doesn't necessarily have the advantage. Mm-hmm. So, we found out a lot about ourselves in Athens. I think we still have a chance to be a fine football team or outstanding, maybe a great football team. We didn't look like it yesterday, but I've seen enough signs to know that the potential is there. If we could put it all together on one Saturday, then we could be. But it's going to take a lot of work and concentration, dedication, and practice, and good job by the coaches and everybody to get our football team ready to play Georgia.
And it will be on national television, 2:30 Saturday afternoon, so I'm glad for you for that. And we'll see you Sunday with the replay. Thank you.
We've been trying awful hard all year long, I have. And a lot of times I felt so inadequate trying to get us to play a football game like we played tonight. And we made mistakes tonight, but we didn't turn the football over. And we did things in the clutch situations offensively and defensively to win the game. Tonight's going to take away a lot of frustrations. Let's enjoy that. Enjoy that. It's a mighty big win for you, man. It's as big as I've been around in a long, long time. I'm telling you. Big one.
The Auburn Football Review with Coach Pat Dye is brought to you by Colonial Bank.
Welcome to the Auburn Football Review. Auburn whipped Georgia 24-10 at Athens yesterday. Coach, there's not many wins bigger than that one.
Well, it was one that our football team would need a mighty bad man. Our fans needed it, our coaches needed it, our coaches' wives needed it, and it was sweet, to say the least. And, you know, I look at the game, and you got to be proud of so many people, Pat Washington, and the way our defense played down the stretch, and offensively, Bo having the kind of game he had. And
the pressure that was on him.
That's right. And in a hostile atmosphere. But you know, it was a game we hadn't won one like that this year, and I knew that it was there, just a matter of putting it together, and that's what happened.
And those 22 guys from Georgia and assorted coaches and support people must feel good. It's always great to go and win at Georgia.
Well, Phil, you know, in our program at our fans and our coaches and players, we base our season on really what happens in the big games. Not to, you got to win those other ones, but it's Tennessee and Florida and Georgia and Alabama. And I mean, of course, the conference games are big too, but those are the ones.
You wanted to make Georgia throw the football, and you succeeded in that.
Well, I knew if they had to throw it that we would have a chance. And that's what happened. We stopped their running game, and defensive front played extremely well, and I think that lead ball carrier gained 40-something yards, and it was just a great night.
Let's go in the dressing room now and see what's going on here. I think you'll like this.
Talking about bowl. You just didn't show much courage out there tonight, Bo. And Patrick, I'm mighty happy for you, buddy.
Hey, Bo.
Conscious of a lot of pressure, people talking about you and everything.
No. Pressure don't bother me. It's just taking all the criticism.
No, just decided you wasn't going to let him in the end zone.
Huh? Right. Don't let him catch it. Don't let him catch it.
How about the play you made on the goal line when, well, it's two or three, huh?
Hey.
You like this Georgia game, don't you?
I'm just thinking for the Lord. But, you know, I thought he had me beat, you know, on the slant, so... You know, I just got my hand and tried to knock it down. Said, well, if I get pass interference, number five, Yubbin has it to the goal line. So
I batted up and more balls today than I can remember. You think
yeah,
so?
Yeah, we did
a long time.
How about it?
Really sweet. Yeah,
it. You were you a hurdler in high school?
No, I wasn't. But I wanted that touchdown. I wanted
you
that.
Almost.
Yeah, I almost got it. Just
1 o'clock. I think we wanted to keep it low at first, and it was just among the offensive linemen that we were going to go out and just block our hearts out and hope he had a good game.
You think he had a good game?
Yeah, I think he did. And my attitude is Bo for Heisman.
All right, Steve Wallace says he's starting a Bo for Heisman fan club. You want to be president?
Yeah. I'm the president of the Bo for Heisman.
I'm the treasurer. What do you want? You be vice president.
I can take it.
Everybody say aye.
I am a member. I'm one of the original founders with Ben Tamborello. We're the ones that started it.
How about Ben Washington? They said he couldn't win a big game. He couldn't make a big play on the field. How about that?
Well, I never lost confidence in myself. I felt like I could do something to help this football team, and I had the opportunity today, and I'm glad it happened.
He's been coming, and he did a few things out there today that you don't ever practice. And the one he dumped off the bowl in the long run, bowl was in a blocking pattern, and the blocking broke down, and he just found it. Another one to Jeff Harts, both of them critical long yardage situations. He had a couple of key runs, and he was in control of the game the whole time. The no turnover speaks for it, and they were coming after him trying to put pressure on him.
I had to stop that fullback play to keep him from bending it back and making those big yards.
Yeah, we had a little trouble with it. They found out how we were playing it, you know, and then they changed up, and then we changed up, you know, so it kind of equaled out. They got a few big plays on it, but I think for the most part, we pretty well, you know, we did a decent job on it. I won't say we stopped it cold.
Feel good?
Yeah, feel real good. We won a game at home.
When you going home?
Tomorrow.
Yeah. What you gonna do?
I'm gonna fly to the mall and walk around a little bit, see some of the Georgia alumni. And wave.
If you would like to watch over
one of the beautiful stadiums of America, Sanford Stadium, and the first time I can remember it's been warm there for this.
Well, it was, you know, the day reminded me of 1959 when we played Auburn. It was a hot, humid day, and I played in that one. Is, you know, you got to feel like things are going to bounce your way when we come right out and that ball hit Jeff Lott in the back. They had good pressure on Pat and hit his arm, and the ball went down and hit Jeff Lott in the back, and Tommy picked it up. And I really think, and now Bo had a great day yesterday, but he's still not 100%.
He would have scored on that play.
I think this was a fine throw and almost a great catch by Jeff Parks. But anyway, they stop us, and we come right back on defense, and as soon as I found out we could stop that running game, that you know, I felt good about the football game, Phil, because I was concerned about controlling the fullback in the running game, and they come out and lose 5 yards the first possession, and Harold Holman and Gerald Williams have big plays, and defensively yesterday we played extremely well throughout the football game, really. They had the one touchdown drive, had some big plays, but overall I thought that you know, they got some easy yardage there in the second half of the late stage of the game. Here's Pat running the option and
on third down.
Right. Offensive staff had a great plan for Georgia, and it was a little different than planning for Georgia running the offense that we're running now as opposed to what we've done in the past, because in the past that defense is set up to run the wishbone against. And Chris Johnson had a great day kicking the football yesterday, and before the game he was kicking 65-yard field goals, and that's the reason we made the decision to go with him all over the field rather than with Chris Knapp.
Mm-hmm. He missed a 47-yarder just a little bit to the right there, and Pat Thomas may have saved the touchdown.
Pat Thomas filling in for Edward Phillips, I think, did a good job in the ball game, made a big play on the reverse there. And
this is third and three.
Come back, and I'm not sure who made those tackles left field, but it's a big play in short yard situation. We stop them, and they miss a field goal here.
Just wide to the right, 50-yarder.
Georgia has gotten better and better as the year's gone along, and they are truly an outstanding football team, and did a great job in the ball game against us yesterday. We didn't have a lot of running room, and we just took advantage of the opportunities that we had. And
great punt here.
The difference in the ball game, Phil, really, is the two turnovers.
Mm-hmm.
They turned it over twice, and actually the punt, the field goal block got us a touchdown, and intercepted the fumble on the pass, got us 3 points, and that was a play that we were most afraid of right there, the cutback, because our people pursued so well. That's Tracy Rocker, and Phil, I'd say right now that there's not a defensive lineman in the country playing any better than Tracy Rocker is, and of course he's a...
There's
a big play right there by Jimmy Warren, caused a fumble, and Russ Character pounced on it, and we end up getting a touchdown here.
Mm-hmm.
Right before the maybe this is when we take down. we get the field goal.
Right.
The field goal here. Pat made a great throw right there, and Fred was in traffic and juggled it a little bit and couldn't quite come up with it. And Chris Johnson kicks a 49 or 50 yard field goal, puts us out front 3-0.
Early in second quarter. First quarter just spent sparring. Two good teams feeling one another out.
As Arthur Johnson played well yesterday in our entire secondary, and Phil, I think that, you know, we got a lot of people playing good on defense. Great play by Gary Kelly there. But the key to us being able to do what we're doing defensively is the play of our secondary.
Mm-hmm.
Because it, we put an awful lot of pressure on them with the passing game, and they're just doing a great job. The corners, Jimmy Warren and Kevin Porter and Tommy Powell and Arthur Johnson. And
James Jackson scored, and they go ahead 7-3.
As Bo, you can see he's got his power and his strength and his speed, but he really doesn't have the quickness. This is a great run right here. There's the power, breaking tackles, and then but cuts back across. A great block right there in the corner of your screen. You can see John Little on the ground. Trey Gaines blocked the last guy that had a chance to make the play, and as Ron Middleton loving him in the end zone, and that's pretty to me. And I really think that right there was the shocker of the ball game. And
answering that touchdown.
Tracy Rocker and Brian Smith. We played a lot of young folks yesterday. Played a lot of folks on defense. Andre Bruce had a great game. And here's a critical play in the ball game that I thought was a very close call. You can see the guy still in bounds right there when Tracy Rocker hits him, and we get the penalty right there. And I'm not so sure that Georgia been on Georgia's sideline because of some of that.
Mm-hmm.
Tommy Powell makes a fine play, and Andre runs him down from behind, and as Gerald Robinson and Arthur Johnson and Pat Thomas, and big play in the ball game right here. Andre Bruce almost a touchdown. He hurdled this guy right there. If he could have stayed in bounds, I guarantee you they couldn't have caught it. We go back on offense, and this is big anytime you can get a score out before the half. And Bo missing the work that he's missed is we're substituting freely, and Pat Washington makes a nice run down to around the 12-yard line, mm-hmm, or something, and Bo runs the ball to the one here.
Inside
we
a
get
minute
a
now.
We get a holding penalty, which is, but this is great. I want you to watch this play right here. That's super right there by Steve Wallace, and Teddy just literally hurdles a guy into the end zone. Watch a play on Steve Wallace. He shields a guy right here without clipping him, and just enough to give Freddie the opportunity to get the ball in the end zone. And but that's that play has been good to us. And halftime is 17-7, and we go in at halftime with the momentum. And we've played a lot of people and really didn't have anybody that was tired in the ball game. And I felt good about our chances at half if we just didn't come out and make any critical mistakes in the second half. And the strange thing about the game, Jack Crow told our football team that we could score 24 points, and if we didn't turn the football over, we'd win it. And that's what he told the squad Thursday night, and Wednesday night in our team meeting. And, of course, that's exactly what happened.
We'll be back in just a minute. 7, but you know Georgia's going to play. You're going to have to beat them in every phase of the game, and you know they're going to stay in the game.
They're a class football team, and you can watch them throughout the game. They fought the whole way, and it was a great football game from that standpoint. Both sides just kept competing and kept playing to win, and Georgia comes right back and goes down the field and gets a field goal. And they complete a couple of passes on us. And again, you know, my biggest concern is not the throwing game, but the running game. Because there's Tracy Rocker again. Goodness, I'm telling you, he's not something. And that guy kicks, a 51-yarder? And
50-yarder.
Makes it 17-10. And Georgia's got a little momentum now. I mean, they've got the crowd behind them, and Bo comes out, and we make a nice run here. And of course, we get it to, this is probably the worst thing they did all day long, is not making a first down. We had it second and one, and
place went crazy then.
Well, that's right. And like I said, Georgia picked up the momentum, but that crowd we got playing defense, they don't understand that. And there's Benji Rowland, Eastman, Georgia, causing the fumble, and we don't come up with it, but I tell you, Benji has gotten better and better every snap, and Auburn folks going to enjoy watching him play for the next 3 years. As Andre Bruce, Andre, I know, had to play his finest game yesterday. Pat Washington making a key throw right here to Scott Bolton, and just it was a team win.
Look at him, look play at and
catch. Look at this effort by Trey Gaines right here. Now, he's not down yet. He almost came out of there with it. Took the ball down to the 18-yard line. Bo makes a great run here on the screen.
Two pass receptions for Bo Jackson in the game.
Right, and here again, you can see Georgia playing defense. They, look at the guys they got around the ball. I mean, now they're playing to win, too. They stop us, block a field goal.
You can never, you know, those guys always, always come back. They always
Well, they've
hard.
Done it over and over and over again. Early in the years, you know, they were down and out against Alabama and block a punt and go ahead in the ball game. They lost it late, but they still kept themselves in position to win. They did the same thing yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
There again is Harold Hallman and Andre Bruce, and there's Ron Stallworth playing, and Gerald Williams didn't play much in the ball game field, and of course he is our great defensive lineman, and that guy, the punting game was out of this world yesterday.
Yeah, right.
That guy did a great job of punting, and Lewis Colbert averaged 47 yards, and it was just a classic game. Here again, you can see Pat scrambling and throws back and finds Jeff Parks and picks up a key first down. Here he gets the ball to Bo and
making something happen.
That was not a design play. It was a play where Pat was getting a blitz and dumped the ball off to Bo, and he turns it into, I think, a 29 or 30-yard gain. Come back, and Brent Fullwood makes a couple of nice runs and gets the ball in there close. And Brent and Bo both were kind of bunged up last week and didn't get a lot of practice, and I was concerned about it. This is a classic Bo Jackson run right here. Watch it. Right there. Four-yard line. Going in the end zone.
That will go in the highlight film there. Here it comes again. Watch the contact here.
Great block by Tommy Agee, blocked by Steve Wilson. A big hole in there, but Georgia, like normal, they closed on it, and he just ran his own interference out for the last 3 yards. And, of course, at that time, they put us 14 points up, and our defense is playing a great play by Arthur Johnson. Breaks through a blocker and a no-gain play, and
they make three drives to try to get back in the game. Auburn stops them each time, and that's what we'll
Jimmy,
see now.
Jimmy Warren, and, you know, I don't know whether they got afraid of Kevin Porter because of the interception, but there's fine play by Nate Hill and Russ Carricker and Brian Smith. There's the interception by Kevin Porter, and Kevin blocked the punt and intercepted a pass and had a great, great ball game. And
Georgia boy.
They're running him out of bounds, and I want to tell you why I'm in the shirt and no tie in a minute. Jimmy Warren making another great play down close to the goal line, and there's a great freshman fullback, Keith Henderson, Andre Bruce, and Harold Hallman, and again the quarterback on the run, and there's Jimmy Warren making another big hit in the end zone, knocks him loose from it. They get it back again. That's pressure. And those front folks up front right there, we got a three-man rush on right here, and great play by Ray Corin.
First and 10 now at the 30.
That comes big old Brian to Harold Hallman, and Jimmy again. Andre Bruce had a dead interception, and Jimmy broke on the ball and got his hands on it and could have come up with the interception himself. They make a fine throw and catch down to the 8-yard line. Time's running out now, though. Again, pressure. Joe Robinson, great play by Kevin Porter.
Boy, this is testing the secondary.
That secondary. Look at that Joe Robinson come in there. Get the ball thrown, and again, a
I tell you, that secondary, they, that's exciting right there. Oh, me. We come back and run the clock out, but I got up early yesterday morning and went downtown to have breakfast. I mean, we went downstairs to really, I guess, have a cup of coffee because I didn't eat till the pregame meal, but and Sue thought I'd got up and got dressed to go to the game, and I had all my clothes in the room there, and when I got back up to after the pregame meal and meeting, she had gone down to eat, and I got undressed to take a shower, and I looked around. I didn't have any clothes to wear, and all my shaving and everything was gone to the airport to come back to Auburn, and I thought, I said, where are my clothes? She said, well, I sent them to the airport. I said, well, so she got all upset about it, and I said, well, don't worry about it. I said, I can wear what I got on, so that's what I wore, what I got up and put on yesterday morning. I didn't get a chance to dress for the game, and she's worried about it. I said, well, listen, I got a lot more to worry about than how I smell and how I look out there on the sidelines. But she said, oh, she's going to send them to the airport every week now.
Frank would have given you a jersey, Coach. We'll be back in just a minute. The Auburn, Florida, Georgia triangle is over. You've got to get your team settled back down for the big game of the year.
None of us escaped unscarred.
No, that's right. I'm telling you.
Oh, man, it's great college football, though. And I tell you, it's games for the players and games for the fans. And you know, it's just... There's no doubt that psychological and emotional swing there has something to do with it. I mean, because we looked at Florida playing against Georgia, and it wasn't close to the Florida team we played against.
We got to go, Coach. Alabama in 2 weeks. We'll have the replay for you then. Thank you. Good afternoon.